Okay, right. Let's proceed, guys. So welcome to imparting training. So in this session, we are going to discuss about the first module of Hadoop ecosystem, that is understanding big data and Hadoop. So in this particular module, we will be discussing both 1.x and 2.x architecture. Okay. So the topics what we'll be covering in this particular topic would be, we will understand what is big data is all about. We will understand IT infrastructure is basically categorized into two things. One is OLTP and OLAP. We will see where exactly the big data or Hadoop falls into. Then we will see, before diving into Hadoop, we will see what is the limitations of existing data analytics architecture and why exactly we are moving into a different analytic architecture like Hadoop. And then we will see moving data into code approach. So there are basically two approaches. One is moving data into code, and there is another approach, what we call it as moving code into data. So there are two approaches. One is moving data into code. Another approach is moving code into data. We will see what is the advantage of each one of them and disadvantage of each one of them. And then we will look into Hadoop 1.x and 2.x core components. However, people don't use 1.x anymore. People have a long back moved into Hadoop 2.x. Then we will look into the Hadoop master and slave architecture. We will see what falls into master and what all services basically falls into slave machines. Okay. Then we will understand something called as blocks. In Hadoop, the data will be broken down into blocks. We will understand more detail what exactly we meant with block. And then we will look into rack awareness. Then we will get into the anatomy of file read and write. We will see how exactly the file is written to Hadoop and how exactly the file is read from Hadoop. And then we'll see the limitations of Hadoop 1.x and why exactly we are moving into 2.x. And then we will look into the MapReduce 1.x execution framework. Okay. With this, can I proceed? Any questions? Okay, so we'll follow this. If you have any questions, please raise your hand so that, you know, I can unmute you. If you don't have any questions, I will proceed. Okay, first let us understand the term, what is big data? Very important. So the definition says big data is just a collection of data set which is so large and complex, which becomes difficult to process using a traditional processing systems. So that is the definition of big data. I'll repeat, big data is just a collection of data set which is so large and complex, which becomes difficult to process using a traditional processing system. What I meant with traditional processing system means any volume of data which becomes difficult to process in one system is generally, we coin it as big data. Okay. So now let us see what are the different sources of big data. Now, you know that, you know, we have different sources of big data. Like, you know, we know that, you know, the Twitter approximately generates 12 terabytes of data every day. So each person logs into Twitter, he tweets it. So approximately Twitter generates 12 terabytes of data. Similarly, you know, the Facebook approximately generates 25 plus terabytes of log data every day. If you look into this, there are various devices, various social media network, so many things which generates huge volume of data. Let me take a practical example here. Now, I will take up a use case of telecom. Now, approximately, if I ask you a question, how many people will make a call in 1 minute, for example, in, let's say, in Banashankari? Can anybody tell me? Ranjan? Can you unmute and can you tell me approximately how many people will make a call in, let's say, on a particular area in Bangalore?
Sorry, no idea.
Approximately. I need not have the correct number. Approximately how many people will make a call per minute in a particular area, let's say Banashankari?
Can't say actually, because it's based on the population.
Approximately. Approximation is not the correct answer. Approximately.
Think of like maybe 1 lakh people.
Okay, approximately you say that, you know, per minute the number of calls made in entire a particular region, let's say 1 minute. Okay, that is fine. Now, can you tell me per minute, approximately, how many people will make a call in entire Bangalore per minute? Approximately, maybe somewhere around 1 million?
Maybe, yep.
Yeah. Okay. Now, think about a scenario, how many people will make a call in entire India per minute? Don't you think there's a huge, huge, huge volume of data which gets generated?
Yeah.
Now, all this data gets generated from a mobile phone devices. Any data which gets injected into the system is what we call it as events. Now, we've taken a telecom domain. Now, when you make a call, an event gets generated into the system. When you receive a call, an event gets generated into the system. When you attach your signal to the 2G network, event gets generated into the system. So when you latch your signal from 2G to 3G or 3G to 4G or 4G to 5G, which comes in future, there is always an event gets generated. Whenever there is a certain amount of bandwidth, if it reaches, then event gets generated. When you're trying to roam from one particular region to another particular region, when the signal latches to a different network element, there is an event gets generated. Okay. So if you look into this, let's take a use case. As a telecom operator, I want to find out the call usage pattern. Please understand the use case. As a telecom operator, I want to find out the call usage pattern for 3 months. Now, please understand, we're talking about per minute the data getting generated, which is in millions. I'm talking about doing the performing an analysis on 3 months volume of data. Don't you think it's a very huge volume of data? Okay, now telecom operator to make some decisions, they want to perform an analysis on huge volume of data. For example, now they want to invest something on to improve their infrastructure. For example, they want to improve the 4G network. Now, for example, they can't install the 4G network. They can't improve the 4G network randomly, you know, in some areas. Now they want to find out which regions has more number of subscribers of 4G and where there is no much 4G network available there. So if we install the network elements on the regions where there are more subscribers, I get more revenue. So those kind of use cases for me to perform, I want the historical data. I'm clear? So all this data we collected and we stored it into the data warehousing systems like Hadoop. We'll come back to that. Okay, any questions here? So you will have different use cases like this. Say, for example, another use case, if you want to, you know, release some campaigns, I want to release some offers. Now, all these offers will not be released to all different, for all the customer segments, it will not be released. Now, I want to find out if the offer is released for which segment of people will lead more revenue to me. So I want to know those kind of patterns that, you know, all those things can be executed on the huge volume of data if I want the results to be accurate. Okay. So that is why the use cases for the accuracy of the use cases requires huge volume of data. Okay. Now we have certain use cases which does, you know, the device data analysis. So it will also give the reports during the course. I will show you the real-time reports. It will also show you that, you know, which manufacturing device has highest call drop and which manufacturing model number has the most, you know, the call drop occurring in a particular device. Now the operators like, you know, Airtel, Vodafone, they try to purchase this, you know, the use cases. So the use case will tell you that, you know, it will help you to find out that which particular mobile has a faulty, can be a hardware faulty, can be a software, which is leading to more call drop. And just because of these devices, what is the revenue loss that a particular telecom operator is trying to get? So we will try to analyze all these things with a huge volume of data. Okay. Any questions here? You can always raise your question if you have. Okay. So that is what we have different sources of big data. This would be the very important interview question. Can you tell me the source of your data? In my case, in my company, the source, the since I work for telecom, the source for the data is network elements, or in other words, I can say mobile devices. So the data gets injected for every event. It can be that, you know, if you're making a call, you're receiving a call, you're connecting to the network, a signal strength latches to a different network. All those events get generated every second. Okay. Now, let me proceed. Now, as I told you that IT infrastructure is basically categorized into two things. One is OLTP and another one is OLAP. Now, can anybody tell me what is OLTP or OLAP? Anybody? Veena? Do you have any idea about OLTP and OLAP?
No, sir.
Okay.
As of now, I'm not getting.
Okay. Okay. See, IT infrastructure is basically, the IT systems are basically is into two categories. One is what we call it as OLTP. So OLTP stands for online transactions and processing. Please understand this. So wherever you have a concept of OLTP, Hadoop doesn't come into the picture. That means Hadoop is never designed for transactions and processing. Hadoop or the big data systems is designed for handling OLAP. That means online analytical and processing. This is very important. So that is why Hadoop is not designed for performing insertion, deletion, updates. It is not designed for that. It is meant for, you know, OLAP kind of an operations. Any questions here? If you have any questions, please raise your hand so that, you know, we can get into the discussions. Okay. So one point to note here is Hadoop falls into OLAP or big data systems falls into OLAP, never OLTP. For designing OLTP systems, we have different architecture. RDBMS would be the best choice. Okay, and similarly, you have some sort of a databases like NoSQL, which achieves OLTP. Okay. Now let us see the limitations of existing data analytic architecture, a very important slide. Now let's assume you have different sources of data. You get data from different sources, for example. You get data from different sources. The source of the data can be your application logs. The source can be your application logs. Or it can be your mobile devices. It can be your mobile devices, or it can be your actual applications, user applications. It can be the events data which gets generated. There can be different sources of the data. Now, initially what we used to do was, all the data which gets generated from different sources, we used to store into our systems, what we call it as SAN, which stands for Storage Area Network. SAN stands for Storage Area Network. One thing important to remember here is the source which used to send the data used to store in systems, what we call it as SAN. Now there is no point in just storing the data, right? We have to analyze the data. So SAN was not having capability to analyze. So what we used to do is we used to move the data to ETL compute grid. So here, what is ETL stands for is extract the data from the SAN, transform the data. Transformation includes based on your business use case. For example, in, let's assume in telecom data, you get some events, some attributes for a particular data. For example, let's say call, start, and another attribute of the data, let's assume call end. Now, what could be the transformation here is, let's assume your live data is sending two columns. Your live data is sending two columns, and this data is what is there in the SAN. Now, you extracted the data from SAN. One example of transformation could include that I want to perform certain KPIs. For example, I want to find out call duration. Your live data, your network data, what you get from the telecom thing, you may not get call duration. You have to compute the call duration from these two columns. So how do you compute? A simple formula, call end minus call start, correct? So we compute this, we perform a transformations on that data, okay? And then load the data into the destination systems like RDBMS, where all your aggregations and all will take place. And you have different reporting BI tools for performing your analytics. So this was the existing, long back, a solution before Hadoop came into the picture. Can anybody tell me, can you identify any limitations of this architecture? Anybody? Can you tell me what is the what could be the limitations of this architecture? I think Naveen also have joined. Naveen, can you just show some light on this?
Static data.
It can be a live data also, Naveen. The data, I am not distinguishing it as static data. It can be a live data also. Always, you know, the source will send the live data. What could be the limitations of this architecture? Anybody, Ranjan?
Takes more time to
process. Okay. Now, if you look into this architecture, the reporting tools, we are not directly attaching to the raw data. So what we are doing is we are trying to take the data to the systems where your ETL used to happen, ETL compute grid. Okay. Now, ETL compute grid is, initially it was not parallel. Parallel execution was not taking place. It was one single node. It was one single node. That means if you have very huge volume of data, the data used to move into the ETL compute grid, which is not scalable. This is very important. The ETL compute grid is not scalable. Just because it is not scalable, it used to take more time for the computations. And then we used to process the data. That means we used to perform ETL, and then we used to send the data to the RDBMS. And then you have different reporting tools attached to the RDBMS. That means one important limitation you should see, this particular layer is never doing processing. It was not doing processing. Processing used to happen on the ETL compute grid. Don't you think there's a lot of bandwidth is required to move the data from the SAN to the ETL compute grid? Yes or no? So this was the main limitation of existing analytic architecture, that is before the invent of Hadoop. Any questions before I proceed to the next slide? Okay, so I see there's no questions. Let me proceed. If you have any questions, please raise your hands, guys. This is very important. Okay, now. So I've put the limitations. You can have a look at it. Now, what is the solution? This is a very important slide, which will give you the details of, you know, the idea behind Hadoop. Now, if you look into the previous slide, can anybody tell me where the data used to store? Veena, where the data used to store? Data used to store in SAN or data used to store in ETL compute grid?
SAN.
Where the computation used to happen?
ETL.
And another layer where the computation used to happen? On the RDBMS?
Yes.
For executing the aggregation queries?
Yes.
Because in the ETL layer, we don't do aggregation. We just extract the data, do transformations, and simply load the data to the RDBMS. And your business tools used to attach to the RDBMS where your query used to get executed. Correct?
Yes.
Now, if you look into the Hadoop layer, this is very important. Please understand this. If you read the title, it's a combined storage compute layer. If you look into the title, it is called as a combined storage compute layer. That means Hadoop is a framework, please understand this. Wherever the storage used to happen, computation used to happen there. This is the whole idea of Hadoop, the invent of Hadoop. The existing architecture, storage was separate layer, processing was separate layer. So a lot of data transfer used to happen. Now in the Hadoop, it is called a combined storage compute layer. That means wherever the data is stored, computation will happen on the same node. That is the whole idea behind Hadoop. Okay, so you had a different sources of data. The data used to store into Hadoop. And then what we used to do, wherever the data is stored, computation will happen on the same node. That is what is the whole idea behind Hadoop. A combined storage compute layer. Okay, and however, even now we move the data to the RDBMS, that is for a different purpose. We do aggregation on this Hadoop layer itself. it is not required to move the data to RDBMS. It is not required. However, you can do it. But one advantage is you can attach your business reporting tools directly to Hadoop. It is not required to attach to the RDBMS. You can attach your business tools directly to Hadoop. Any questions here?
So here the storage, and once we store it and then compute it, the aggregation also will happen at the same layer, at the Hadoop layer?
Exactly. So that's what I was trying to tell you. So it is meant for storage, it is meant for compute. Your compute is not just ETL. Okay. So it is also with your aggregations. Okay. However, in the Hadoop, in the batch processing layer, we don't call this as ETL. We call this as ELT. There's a difference. Extract, transform, and load. If you look into this, we are not transforming and loading into the system. We are loading the data into the systems. And then if you want to perform the transformation, we go into the concept of ELT. Extract, load, and then transform. Okay, so that is the architecture which is becoming popular now, ELT. Extract the data, load the data, and then do transformation. Okay. Any questions here?
So Hadoop is ETL or ELT?
Please raise your hand. It will be helpful so that for me to unmute. Okay. Ranjan, what is your question?
Naveen this side.
Yeah, Naveen.
Hadoop is ELT or ETL?
No, why that? You can't compare ETL and ELT to Hadoop, right? What is ETL? ETL is... See, ETL and ELT is nothing to do with Hadoop. Before the invent of Hadoop also, we used to do ETL. What is ETL? You extract the data from a source, then do certain transformation on the data, and then load the data. Loading the data, extracting the data can be your RDBMS also. Clear, Naveen?
Okay. Yeah.
And try to understand this. That's a very good question you asked me. Hadoop, you can't compare Hadoop with ETL or ELT. ETL is you have your data source. First, ETL, you extract the data. The source can be anything. The source, even it can be your RDBMS. Extract the data, perform certain transformation, some business logic, and load the data back to another RDBMS. This is also an ETL. Nothing to do with Hadoop. Okay. Now there is another category word, we generally call it as ELT. That means you extract the data, extract the data and load the data to RDBMS and then perform transformations. So that is what we call it as ELT. Nothing to do with Hadoop here.
So can I know what advantage we can get with the ELT here?
Okay, what advantage you get here is, now if you see this, let's assume, you know, you have a source which generates, you know, column 1, column 2, column 3, for example. Okay, now you extract the data and transform the data. For example, I told you that you have call start, call end, and let's assume there's only two column, call start and call end. So during ETL, what happens is you extract the data, perform some transformation. Let's assume I will compute the call duration. Then there can be scenario while loading back to the any of the data warehousing system, I may reject these two columns. Possible? So I will load only the call duration here. Okay. Now when I load only the call duration, maybe that I don't have this information once the data gets loaded into the data warehousing system. Correct?
Okay.
Think about a scenario again. Let's assume I will not reject these records. I will compute call duration. So when I store the data into the data warehousing system, I will store call start, call end, as well as call duration. Let's assume this is a scenario. Okay. Now think about disadvantage of this approach. Assume if I store two columns, let's assume it takes 1 TB. If I want to store additional column, let's assume it will take another, for example, 0.5 TB. Don't you think the overall size now it is 1.5 TB? Whereas if I get into the concept of ELT, you don't compute the call duration. You simply load the data into the system. At runtime, I will compute the call duration. So with that, you know, I'll reduce the space also. Right, Navin?
So you mean to say that at runtime, we load the data?
Not runtime, we load the data. Runtime, we compute the call duration.
Okay, compute the call duration, okay.
So that is how the architectures are getting into from ETL to ELT approaches in the industry. Why I'm trying to tell you all these things, in interview, they will ask you, can you tell me the evaluation of your product? How did your product evolve? How did you improve your product? So we were using ETL for some of the things. Then we find out that there's no point in doing ETL for those kind of a things. Then we used to do ELT for some of the use case.
So now Hadoop, it supports ELT?
Navin, again, please understand. It is not Hadoop. You can't ask me the difference between ETL, ELT to Hadoop. Hadoop is just a storage layer. That's all. To answer a point, it will support.
Okay.
There is nothing speciality that Hadoop has given for that. It is just a storage.
Okay.
So there's no question of ETL, ELT whether Hadoop supports. No. The questions, two are different entities. Okay. To answer a question in precise, yeah, it will. Okay. Let me proceed. Any other questions, guys? Okay, very good questions, guys. Let's get into the next one. This is a very important slide. We will see how to process data in enterprise. So think about a scenario. Let's assume you have one machine. This machine has four input-output channels. What I meant with input-output channels means it has four hard disks. This particular system has four hard disks, and each channel is capable of reading or processing 100 megabytes per second. Please understand this. So this is the traditional approach before the invent of Hadoop. So that is what I was talking about, the big data, all those things. So you have, let's assume you have one single machine and you have four input output channels, and each channel is capable of processing 100 megabytes per second. Okay, let's assume you have a scenario. Now, can you tell me how much time it takes to process 1 terabyte of data? So you have a machine, this machine is capable of processing it has four hard disks. Each hard disk is capable of processing 100 megabytes per second. That means approximately per second, it is capable of processing 400 megabytes per second. And if you see, 1 terabyte is not huge. 1 terabyte is not huge when I'm talking about big data. It is less only. Now, how much time it takes to process 1 terabyte of data is approximately, it takes 45 minutes. Please understand this. It takes 45 minutes to process just 1 terabyte of data. Now, the limitation here, if you see, the computer, this particular computer has limitation in terms of processing because it can capable of processing only 400 megabytes per second. And another limitation, if you see, the computer is not scalable. The load of the data, we were not dividing the load of the data into different machines, and then we were not processing the data in parallel. So this is the main limitations of existing thing where the data is to process. Any questions here? Okay, so I see no questions. Let me proceed. Now, if you look into the Hadoop approach, please understand this approach. It's very important. Let's assume you have same 1 terabyte of data. And if you look into the Hadoop approach, Hadoop basically is a cluster. You will have collections of machines, Can you see this? You have multiple machines, which all interconnected to each other, Now, let's assume you have same 1 terabyte of data and you have 10 machines. Please understand this. Before it was one machine, now it is 10 machines. And each machine has four input-output channels, that is four hard disks. And each hard disk is capable of processing 100 megabytes per second. Okay. So now if you see this, the total time taken to process 1 terabyte of data will be approximately 4.3 minutes. Correct? But any questions? I'm expecting some questions to ask here. So approximately takes 4.3 minutes. But ideally, what you were expecting the number to be? So if you see this here, it takes 45 minutes. So 45 divided by 10, approximately it should have been?
4.5.
Please understand, it is not 4.3. It will be somewhere around 5 minutes. It will not be 4.5. It will be more than 4.5, approximately 5 minutes. Can anybody tell me why? Or any questions in this slide? I'm expecting some questions. Yeah, Rashid, go ahead.
Yes, so here data is scattered, right, in multiple machines.
Rather than scattered, I can say data is split.
Split, okay. So in that case, the same program will need to communicate to, there should be a more of communication here, right?
Correct. That is the reason, let's assume you have written a program. Okay, you submit your program to the cluster.
Yeah.
Okay, the program has to be moved into all the machines where your data is there.
Yes.
So if you see the approach, I was talking about the approach, right? If you remember, I told you Hadoop is basically a storage compute layer. That means wherever the data is stored, computation happens there. So the program, whatever you have written, has to be moved into the systems where your data is stored. That is one reason it takes little more time. And another reason it takes little more time is, it will not be directly divided by 10. The data, 1 terabyte of data, some portion of the data may be in this machine. Some portion of the data is there in this machines, correct? So final results has to be collate, right? Final output has to be collated from different machines, right?
Yes.
So this, the shuffle will take time. That is why it is slightly more than the actual calculation what you did.
Oh, okay.
Okay, all those things we will see in detail again once we start coding. Very good, Rishit. Any questions here? Any questions here before we proceed? Okay, right. Let me proceed to the next slide then. Now, what is Apache Hadoop? So from here, I'll go a little slow. So if you have any single question on this particular slide, please ask a question. Now, can anybody tell me what is the challenge of big data? Can anybody tell me what is the challenge of big data? What is the main challenges of big data? There are two main challenges of big data. First challenge is storage. The second challenge is processing. To solve the big data problem, a framework has evolved, what we used to call it as Hadoop. So what is Hadoop? So in simple definition, Hadoop is a framework that allows distributed processing of large data sets across clusters of commodity computers using a simple programming model called MapReduce. I'll reiterate the definition again. What is Hadoop? Hadoop is a framework which is used to solve the big data problem. What is the main problems of big data? One is the storage and another one is processing. Or in other words, I can say Hadoop is a framework which allows distributed processing. That means we know, right, Hadoop basically have collections of machines. Hadoop will have collections of machines, process the data in distributed processing. That means in parallel in multiple machines. and it is meant or it is designed for lodging. It is designed for storing large data set across clusters of commodity computers. What I meant with commodity computers means each machine need not be a powerful machine. It can be a low-end hardware also. And to process, Hadoop provides you a simple programming model called MapReduce. Any questions here? Any questions, you can raise your hand. Okay. Now, what does Hadoop provide? Please understand this. This is a very, very important point. What does Hadoop provide? Hadoop provides you MapReduce. What is MapReduce? MapReduce is a programming model to process the data in distributed file system. For now, you can only understand that. What is MapReduce? MapReduce is a programming model to process the data in distributed file system, or it is used to process the data in parallel where the data is stored in distributed file system. So Hadoop provides you MapReduce. Please understand this. The main advantage of using Hadoop framework, Hadoop provides you a MapReduce. That means you need not break your head. You need not break your head to write a parallel applications. Hadoop provides you a MapReduce model. When you use that MapReduce model, the programs will be executed in parallel automatically. So that is one advantage of using Hadoop. It provides you MapReduce. Now look at this. The next thing what Hadoop provides you is failover mechanism. For example, let's assume you have collection of machines. Let's assume you have four machines. In Hadoop terminology, we call this as data nodes. I will come back to that again. Let's assume you have four nodes for now. You have four nodes. Node 3, node 4, node 2, and node 1 for now. So let's assume you have some data. The data will be stored in this machine. Data will be stored in this machine. For example, data will be stored in this machine, for example. Okay. Now, what happens while, let's assume, you know, what happens, you know, when the data is processing? When the data is processing, there can be a chances that this machine, all of a sudden, it failed. All of a sudden, let's assume it got shut down. So please understand this. We as a developer, we don't write any single code to bring failover mechanism. Hadoop will take care. How does it take care? We will see in the next slide. If any one of the machine fails, what happens to this data? If you ask me a question, Hadoop will take care. How it will take care? We will see in the next slide. So that means when you start writing an applications, you will never concentrate to build the framework to concentrate on failover. Hadoop as a framework does that. Okay. Any questions here? Okay. Data distribution. Now, if you look into this, as I told you, let's assume you have a huge volume of data. When you copy this data into the Hadoop cluster, you have node 1, you have node 2, you have node 3. When you copy this huge volume of data into the Hadoop cluster, how the data will be distributed, you as a developer, you need not write any single line of a code to tell how the data has to be distributed. Hadoop framework takes care of the data distribution. Please understand this. That is the whole point of using Hadoop. So a lot of things as a framework, it will take care. If there is no Hadoop, you would have ended up writing more code to building this kind of a systems. Okay. So that is what is data distribution. Now, moving code to data. I told you that let's assume you write some business logic. You write some business logic. I want to copy this code into the machines where your data is there. So you need not write a single line of a code to tell how the code has to be moved into the systems where your data is there. Hadoop will take care of those things. So that is why Hadoop, the advantage of using Hadoop is Hadoop provides you a MapReduce programming model. So when you start coding using MapReduce, you have a way where you can execute your code in parallel in distributed file systems. So Hadoop provides you a failover. If any one of the node fails, what should happen for the data? Hadoop will handle those failover mechanisms. Hadoop will take care of data distribution. When you copy the data into the Hadoop cluster, how the data has to be distributed, Hadoop will take care of all those things. Similarly, moving code to data. So when you submit a particular job how the code should move to the systems where your data is there. So you need not write a single line of a code for that. Hadoop as a framework will take care of all those things. And Hadoop provides you heterogeneous hardware. That means you can have a machine with high end, you can have a machines with low end, possible. So Hadoop handles, you know, heterogeneous hardware. Hadoop provides you scalable. That means let's assume today you have only three nodes. Tomorrow I may add additional nodes because I get more volume of data. I have to add more nodes. So Hadoop provides you scalable automatically without you writing any single line of a code. Any questions here, guys, before we proceed into the next slide? So what is Hadoop? Hadoop is a framework which allows distributed processing of large data sets across clusters of commodity computers using a simple programming model called MapReduce. Any questions here? Okay, so if you have no questions, let me proceed. Now, we will look into the approach moving data into code. We will look into this approach, moving data into code. So initially I told you that we used to have a system called SAN where the data used to store, correct? Now, let's assume you have a client who wants to analyze this terabytes of data. So what happens is the approach is moving data into the systems where your code is there. So your code is there in these machines. Your code is there in these machines. Your data is there in these machines. Okay. Now, so if a client wants to analyze this terabyte of data which used to store in SAN, in the approach of moving data into code approach, what used to happen is the data used to move from the storage, to the systems where your code is there. So that means that entire terabyte of data used to move to the systems. Okay. Can you see any limitations of this approach? Anybody? Because let's keep the session as interactive as possible. Can you see any limitations of this approach, Ranjan?
Time.
Yeah, input, output.
Rather than input output, I can say a lot of bandwidth.
Network bandwidth.
The network bandwidth. Correct, right? Because terabytes of data, when I'm talking to the big data, it is very small. Correct? So a lot of data transfer used to happen from the storage layer to the compute layer. Can anybody think of any other limitations here? Can anybody try this?
And processing capacity also is a challenge.
Right. Can you see this? The processing capacity of this particular machine. Maybe less because it doesn't process the data in a cluster. Yeah, that's a very good limitation.
Suppose you move the data, you always need a better memory capacity of machine to process the data.
Correct. Correct. And don't you think another limitation you can actually see, there can be some sort of a sniffing happening here. Network sniffing happening. The data security is an issue. You can install some third party network packet sniffer to sniff your actual data, because when the data transfer over the network where your client is not on the premises, where you know there can be a lot of data transferring happen, and there can be a network, some sort of a sniffer software installed to steal your data. Yes or no?
Yes, there is a possibility.
Right. So that is the main limitation of the approach moving data into code approach. Now we will get into the next approach. In this approach is what we call it as moving code to data approach. Now please understand this approach. This is what is Hadoop does with this approach, moving code to data. So what happens, as we know that Hadoop basically stores the data in distributed. It is basically, Hadoop is basically cluster of machines. Everybody understand the term cluster of machines, right? Okay, assume the silence as yes. So Hadoop stores the data in the cluster of machines, or Hadoop is basically a cluster computing. Now, let's assume you have a client who wants to analyze the data. So in Hadoop, you are aware that, you know, when I copy the data to the Hadoop, the data will be broken down and it will store in the machines. We will see how it will be broken down in the next slide. So here you have a client who wants to analyze the data. So what does client write? He will write MapReduce programming. So he will submit this MapReduce. Please understand this. He will submit the MapReduce to the cluster. So what does MapReduce happen? Once he submits the program to the cluster, the MapReduce program will be broken down into blocks. This is very important. It will be broken down into blocks. Now, in each machine, since the data is there, it will process the data. And finally, it consolidates the results. And finally, it gives back the data to the client. Okay, so this is what is the Hadoop approach, or approach of moving code to data approach. So this is what Hadoop follows. Any questions here?
Sir, here I did not get that block here. The Which code, into the block into each storage device. Mm-hmm. So how the code will be split, or the same code will be distributed to all?
It is an instance. It is not that code will be split. Multiple objects will be created.
Okay.
It is not the code will be split.
Yes.
The same code will be executed on multiple machines. Okay.
Got it.
Any other questions, guys?
So what is jobs here?
The job can be any of your, for example, SQL query. I want to find out the average call drop for a particular region. That can be a job. Some analysis can be a job. Yeah, Rashid, go ahead.
Naveen, so just in the previous slide where you're explaining the Hadoop's features, you told the data is distributed and that they have a fail, like there can be failover mechanism, right?
Correct.
So here, when they are processing that, so something like some one block is not available, like how Correct. Does
the... That is the reason I didn't tell you still how the data is distributed. That I will discuss detail in the next slide. Still, you didn't get the complete idea how the data will be distributed, which you will get it in the next slide. Okay. See, let's assume there is 1 terabyte of data. It is not that this 1 terabyte of data will be there in all the machines. It is not that, let's assume in this case, you have 6 machines. This 1 terabyte of data will be divided by 6 and it will be copied into each machine. It is not this calculation.
Oh, okay.
So that is why next slide, I will clearly tell you how the data is distributed. So some data, let's assume you have a file by name employee file. You have a file by name employee.dat file. Let's assume this is 1 terabyte of data. When you copy this employee.dat file into the Hadoop cluster, it is not that this employee.dat file, it is 1 terabyte divided by 6 and it will copy the to each machine. It is not this calculation. Okay. Any other questions, guys?
Here, jobs are same. All the jobs are same. Different jobs and different purpose.
It can be different jobs, obviously, right? Different jobs for different purpose, right? Always, when I say job, it is a task. Clear?
Okay.
If you have any doubts, please stop me. I will help you out because it's a very, very foundation for your complete big data. Okay. Now we will look into different distributing vendors for Hadoop. There are 2 popular distributing vendors. However, now they have been merged into one single distributing vendor. For now, the most popular distributing vendor for Hadoop is Cloudera. So others, you know, they don't use it. So there is only one single distributing vendor now, that is Cloudera, where we call it as CDH. So they are the distributing vendor of your complete big data. So when you install Cloudera, it comes with all preloaded set of softwares for you. And it provides you a convenient way to, you know, configure the cluster to improve, to, you know, if I want to add more nodes into the cluster, Cloudera provides you a way to add basically more nodes into the cluster with a graphical user interface. So CloudEra is one of the most popular distributing vendors. Out of 100 companies, I can see 95 plus of the companies uses CloudEra. So if in interview, if they ask you that, oh, what is the distributing vendor you have used? The option should be CloudEra, or it can be your vanilla Hadoop. That means your raw Hadoop you have installed freshly from scratch. The advantage of using the vendors like CloudEra is you will get a support. Since Hadoop is an open source, for any of the bugs, you may not get the fix immediately. Whereas the CloudEra is a community which is licensed. So you have to purchase the license for them from them based on number of nodes. So any issue, the CloudEra company will help you out to resolve your issue. So CloudEra is very, very widely used. Any questions here? Okay, let me proceed. So others don't concentrate, it is of, they don't use it anymore. Now, please focus on this slide. It is very, very important slide. Now, what is Hadoop? Hadoop, as I told you, that Hadoop is a framework which provides you solution for big data. So as I told you, what are the main problems of big data, guys? What are the two challenges of big data?
Storage and processing.
Storage and processing, right? So now please understand this. Hadoop has two main components. If you understand this slide, you will understand what is Hadoop. Hadoop has two main components. So one thing we already discussed, the problems of big data is the first problem is storage. And the second problem is processing. So Hadoop has two main components. The first component is HDFS. Now, before getting into the HDFS, can you tell me in Windows, each hard drive, the drive, whatever you have, will have a file system? What is the file system what Windows uses?
FAT32.
FAT32 or NTFS?
Yes.
Can anybody tell me what is a file system? Okay. What is a file system is? File system is a piece of a software which will break your data into smaller chunks, what we call it as a blocks, and stores into your actual disk. That is a file system. That means if you copy any file to a particular disk, based on the file system it uses, it tries to break the file into smaller chunks and it tries to store it into the hard disks, your physical disk. Okay, that is a file system. Now, Hadoop has two main components, right? One is the file system and another one is processing. Since Hadoop also has a component of file system, it has a file system by name HDFS. Please understand this. Hadoop is basically comprises of two main components. One is HDFS. HDFS here stands for Hadoop Distributed File System. Please understand this. It is not a normal file system. The file system itself is distributed across cluster of machines. That means, what is a file system? We have understood any data you keep it into the drive based on the file system you're using, the data will be broken down into blocks of whatever the size depending on your file system. Now, the specialty of HDFS is it is a distributed file system. What I meant with this distributed file system is, let's assume you have a cluster of machines. There is one single file system across all the cluster. Wherever as a Hadoop is installed, there is one single file system, that is HDFS. The file system itself is distributed file system. That means any data you copy from this machine is accessible from this machine, because there is only one file system which sits on top of your each Linux file system. So there is one single file system, which is distributed file system. Any single question here? Okay, I see there's no questions. Let me proceed. So,
one question here.
Yeah.
Normally, Hadoop is installed in the Linux machines, right?
Correct. That is why, if you remember, I told you that you have node 1, you have node 2, you have node 3. Your HDFS sits on top of your Linux file system.
So, it doesn't use the Linux file system, it uses the Windows file system.
It sits on top of your Linux file system.
Okay, but that means it is a system file system that utilizes the Linux file system.
Correct.
Okay.
Okay, but the specialty is it is distributed file systems. That means there is one single HDFS for the cluster of machines. Okay, very good. Okay, then the next important component is MapReduce. So it is, there's no point in simply storing the data, right? We should also process the data. So Hadoop provides you a component by name MapReduce to process the data in parallel in cluster of machines. To support these two components, so I told you that Hadoop provides you a component for storage. Hadoop provides you a component for processing. For storage, we have HDFS. For processing, we have MapReduce. To support these two components, that is your HDFS and your MapReduce, Hadoop provides you five daemon services. Please understand this. Hadoop provides you five daemon services. To support these two components, one is your storage and another one is your processing, Hadoop provides you five daemon services. The first service is what we call it as a name node. We will look into each service, what it does. For now, try to understand Hadoop provides you five daemon services. First one is your name node. Second one is your data node. Third is your secondary name node. Fourth is your job tracker. Fifth is your task tracker. Five daemon services. Out of these five daemon services, three services are meant for storage. What are all those things? One is your name node. Out of five services, three services are meant for storage. One is your name node, and another one is your data node, and third one is your secondary name node. And two services are meant for processing. One is your job tracker, and another one is your task tracker, which I have mentioned here. Okay, any questions here? What each service does, we will get into the next subsequent slides, but for now you understand Hadoop is a framework which has two main components. One is your HDFS and another one is your MapReduce. HDFS is meant for storing, MapReduce is meant for processing. If you have any questions, please raise your hand so that I know who is asking the question. Guys, please keep yourself on mute. I can hear a lot of background noise. Naveen, if you don't keep yourself on mute, I'll be removing you. Okay, right. Any questions? I'm expecting some questions on this slide. It's a very important slide. Okay, I see there's no questions. Let me proceed.
So are you going to explain how this MapReduce?
Please raise your hand. I've already told you several times. The reason I will know who is asking question. Yeah, Ranjan.
So are you going to cover how the MapReduce works in the slides ahead?
Yeah, mandatory. We have a dedicated module, the fourth module for that.
Okay.
Okay, that is very important. This is only the introduction to Hadoop.
Okay.
Okay, all right. Okay, right, let me proceed. Now, so we have seen Hadoop 1.x components. Now let us see 2.x components are very important. So the main difference of Hadoop 1.x and 2.x in terms of services, if you see, so in Hadoop 2.x also, it is meant for storage and it is meant for processing. For storage, we have HDFS. And the services which is related for storage is same. You have name node, data node, and secondary name node. So in terms of storage, there is no much difference in terms of services. Now please look at this. In processing, in earlier versions of Hadoop 1.x, please observe this. This is a very important point. You add only one component for processing. That is your MapReduce. Now, however, out of 100 companies, 99 plus of the companies don't use MapReduce anymore. It is all deprecated. Okay. But however, it is good. You have to understand this, but people don't use MapReduce anymore. Out of 100 companies, I can say 99 plus of the companies will not use MapReduce anymore. It is all deprecated things. But just for the knowledge sake, you have to learn. Okay, that is why the invent of Spark came into the picture. So enough focus should be on Spark. Okay, anyhow. So if we look into this in terms of storage, in terms of services, there is no change. So please observe this. In processing layer, a new component has been introduced. That is what we call it as yarn. We will see more detail about this yarn in the next module. So now for processing, in place of job tracker, you have resource manager. In place of task tracker, you have node manager. This point you have to remember. So one change in terms of services, especially for processing, is in place of job tracker. This is very important. In place of job tracker, you have, I'll make it as RM, that is your resource manager. In place of your task tracker, you will have your node manager. This is one small change from Hadoop 1.x to 2.x in terms of service names. Okay. Any questions here? Okay. So there's no questions. Let me proceed. Now, let us understand HDFS in more detail. Ranjan, can you tell me what is HDFS, full form of HDFS?
Hadoop distributed file system.
What is the speciality of HDFS when compared to the normal file system?
It distributes and stores the data.
Can you elaborate more about that? What do you mean by distribute and stores the data?
It uses the clusters on to store the data. It distributes the, you know, distributes the data into multiple nodes and stores there.
Okay. Yeah, Ranjan, go ahead.
In a master-slave architecture, as you mentioned, there's this architecture, it will be utilizing multiple nodes which is available in the cluster to store the data.
Okay. Maybe after the slide, I'll take up the questions again for you. Then you will be able to answer further. What is HDFS? Please understand the definition. Very important. HDFS is a distributed. You understood what is distributed. That means there is one single file system for collection of nodes. There's one single file system. The file system itself is distributed across cluster of machines. HDFS is a distributed and scalable file system. What I meant with the scalable file system means distributed is very clear that the file system itself is distributed across cluster of machines. When I say scalable file system means you can add additional nodes to the cluster. When you add additional nodes to the cluster, the file system also should be able to scale it. Correct? So HDFS is a distributed and scalable file system. Please understand the next important point. It is designed for storing very large files. Very, very important. This is how you improve the performance of Hadoop, which we will have a tech talk once we are done with the fundamentals. So Hadoop HDFS is a distributed and scalable file system, which is designed for storing very large files. That means HDFS is not designed for storing small files. Please understand this. Hadoop degrades in terms of performance when you have your data as small. So because it is designed for storing very large files, we will see what exactly we meant with that. And as designed for storing very large files running on clusters on commodity hardware. So please observe this. Let's assume you have a data. When I copy this data into the file system, I told you what is file system. The file system is a software which breaks your file into smaller chunks. Okay. So let's assume you have a file. When I save this file, let's assume in Windows, the file will be broken down into blocks. The size of each block in Windows is approximately 512 bytes. That means if you want to read any data, the 512 of bytes will be read continuously from your disk. Okay. So that is in general of the file system. Whereas in Hadoop, HDFS is also a file system, right? Whenever you have your data, whenever you save your data into the file system, especially in HDFS, the file will be broken down into blocks of size 64 MB in Hadoop 1.x. And in Hadoop 2.x, it will store approximately 128 MB. It's not approximate, it is 128 MB. The file will be broken down into block of size 128 MB. Any questions here? Ranjan, you have a question? Oh, I see you raising your hand. If you don't have any question, can you lower your hand? Yeah, Rashid, go ahead.
So you said it is file would be, so it is always the case like file would be equally divided?
Or can you tell me what do you mean by equally divided? Let's assume the file need not be 128 MB. For example, the file can be 130 MB.
Okay, yeah. In that case, so how...
The first block will be 128 MB and remaining block will be your 2 MB.
Okay.
It is not that it will occupy 128 MB completely. It is not that the block size is 128 MB and occupied is only 2 MB. It is not that way.
Okay, so you are telling like I can mention that each block can have 128. Yeah, it is configurable.
Not
so
each block.
Okay, so all together I can say okay, like 128 the block size. So that means the block can have maximum 128 MB. Remaining would go correct to next block.
Correct. And the next block need not be 128 MB because the data is not 128 MB in our case.
Yeah.
In the example,
yeah,
whatever we took.
Yeah.
So it is like this. It is not that, you know, let's assume you are, sorry, let's assume it is not this way. Let's assume you have 130 MB. The first block is 128 MB. And second block, it is not 128 MB. Occupied is only 2 MB. It is not this.
Okay, so it can have maximum 128 MB, but it is occupied 2 MB.
Correct.
Okay, so I cannot configure like different blocks of different size. That is not possible.
Nobody will configure blocks. I mean to say, okay, the block size is configurable.
Okay.
But I didn't understand your question still. I don't know.
So it's like...
to answer your point, block size is configurable.
Yes, that I understood. So it is my question is like, can I say to the system like I should have this many blocks?
No.
And
no. Okay. Clear?
Okay, so yeah, clear. And suppose here you are telling a block size is configurable. Mm-hmm. You can say 128 MB is the block size.
Mm-hmm.
So can I configure like different block, different size? No.
What do you mean by different?
Like in a one block, I want to store 128 MB and another block, I want to store 64 MB.
Why
like
will you do that?
Suppose I know that if I divide, my last block will not be filled. So I want to tell last
you will
block
not know okay, because the data itself, at the real time you get the data, you cannot exactly say that data will be 100 MB. It is impossible.
Yes, in real world. Yeah, it is real world. It's correct. Got you.
Okay. Okay, right. So any other questions? Okay, I see there's no questions. Let me proceed. Now, please understand this.
One more question, sorry.
Yeah, Ranjan, go
ahead. Suppose you have 128 MB block, right?
Mm-hmm.
And in the real time scenario, you are getting a file which is being stored in 5 MB, suppose 10 MB, right?
Mm-hmm.
The rest of the size in the block can be utilized for...
No. That's what I think Rashid asked the question. It is not that it is total size is 128 MB. Occupied is 5 MB. It is not that. Now, the block size itself is 5 MB.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
Okay. We'll take up this slide so that you'll understand. Now, please look at this. As I told you that in Hadoop 1.x, the block size is 64 MB. We'll talk about this. Let's assume you have some employee data. Let's assume the size of this employee data is 200 MB. Now, when you store this DAT file, which is of size 200 MB into Hadoop 1.x, the file will be broken down into blocks of size 64 MB. So 64 MB, 64 MB, 64 MB, and remaining 8 MB is a block size. It is not that block size is 64 and occupied is 8 MB. It is not this. Now the block size itself is only 8 MB because it doesn't have anything else to store.
That means the block size maximum is 64 MB. Lower can be anything, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Now please understand this. In Hadoop 1.x, let's assume, you know, you have 200 MB. 200 MB has been broken down into blocks of size 64, 64, remaining is 8 MB. Now, if I want to read this 200 MB of data, it tries to read four times, correct? From the disk. Correct? Now, to reduce that, in Hadoop 2.x, they've increased the block size to 128 MB. So since they've increased the block size to 128 MB, to read the same 200 MB of data, it can seek only twice from the disk. So it improves the performance. So logically, they've taken a statistics and they've kept it as 128 MB. However, it is configurable. Let's assume you know your data is always 200 MB. Let's assume you know, for example. Then you can change the block size to the complete Hadoop telling 200 MB. Okay. Any questions here?
One question.
Please raise your hand so that I will know who is asking questions.
Okay.
Yeah, Ranjan.
So suppose in real time scenarios, what happens? 0 KB files are getting generated, right?
No. So, this is very important. 0 KB file, only theoretically it will be generated. In the real time, the 0 KB file will never be allowed to store it into Hadoop. This point is very important. That means before storing the data into Hadoop, we will always do ETL. So in the ETL layer only, we will reject the file if it is 0 KB. But however, to answer a point, if the file is 0 KB, there is no block.
Certain times during the transmission phase, if the files are getting generated, right?
I'm telling you again, if it is 0 KB, there is no block.
Okay.
But I also gave you an answer. You will never store a 0 KB file anytime into the system.
No, I understand. Like, we will not be...
I gave you both the answers.
Yeah. No, just to clarify.
No, so, because they will ask you this kind of a scenario questions. Okay. Now, you know, you will never have a scenario where they store 0 KB file. Because, you know, the products will be such matured, you will have a lot of health monitoring which is written on top of your product.
But sometimes because of the developer's mistake, while writing the program, any 0 KB files can be generated. So
possible.
So in that case, the 0 KB file will allocate a block or no block?
No block. It's an empty file.
It's logical, right?
It's an empty file. Okay. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay. I see there's no questions. Let me proceed to the next slide. Please look at this. We will try to skip this slide because it is 1.x. Let us not focus on 1.x. We will focus completely on 2.x, which is very important. 1.x is not used anywhere. So please observe this 2.x architecture. This is very important. So can anybody tell me, Ranjit, can you tell me what are the three daemons which is required for storage? Oh, Ranjan, you're there?
Yes, sorry, I'm talking in mute.
Okay.
Name node, data node, and secondary data node.
Okay, out of these three nodes, where does your data stores?
Data node.
Okay, now please look at this. Hadoop basically follows master and slave architecture. Your actual data will be stored on slave machines. Please make a note. Your actual data will be stored on slave machines. Now, please observe this. In the slave machines, you will have one single machine. Okay, you will have multiple slave machines. In each slave machines, you will have one service related to processing and one service related to storage. Now, can you tell me, don't you think we can decouple this node manager to be in one data node, data node to be in one more slave machine? Is it possible?
Can you come again? I didn't get
that. Is it possible to decouple this node manager and data nodes to different slave machines?
But node manager is supposed to manage the processing of the data node, right?
Correct. So the reason why it is not possible to decouple is because Hadoop follows a combined storage and compute layer. Okay. If they decouple this, it is still possible. I mean, forget in terms of Hadoop, you can decouple the processing and you can decouple the storage. But in Hadoop terminology, in Hadoop world, it is not possible. Why? Because Hadoop follows a storage compute grid layer, right? A combined storage compute layer. That means wherever the data is there, processing should happen on the same nodes. Now, data node is a daemon service which is responsible of managing your blocks. Node manager is responsible of managing the processing in that particular slave machines. If you come back to the master here, can you tell me, you'll have number of nodes dedicated for the master as more, or number of nodes dedicated for the slaves will be more? Veena?
Slaves will be more.
Slaves would be more. Why? Because our data will be stored on the slave machines, and data will be huge. The number of slave machines will be more. Now, if you look into this master node, can you see this in Hadoop 1.x? No, you had only one name node. You had only one name node. I'll tell you what is the functionality of the name node in the next slide. So now if you look into this, you have name node, which is for storage, or which is for processing?
Processing.
Name node is for storage or processing?
It is not storage.
It is for storage. Correct?
Storage happens in the data node, right?
Okay. If you remember the previous slide, I told you that three services are meant for storage.
Yes.
Name node, data node, and your secondary name node.
And a secondary name node.
Your data will be stored on the slave nodes, but name node also stores some data. I will tell you what data it stores. Okay, so now resource manager. See, this is, I'm talking in terms of master here. So resource manager, what is the role of resource manager? Don't you think the role of resource manager is to monitor all your node managers? Yes or no? Now, along with this name node active, in Hadoop 1.x, you had only one name node. That means if this name node fails, no, the entire cluster is gone. So now just hold on. I will explain you what is name node in the next slide. In Hadoop 2.x, you have one active name node and one standby name node. That means if this active name node fails, this standby name node will act like an active. Okay. So it is optional to have name node, second resource manager in the same machine. It can be in two different machines. Obviously, the standby name node will always be in a different machine. And there is another thing called a secondary name node, which will be in a different machines. Any questions? I'm expecting a lot of questions on this slide so that you can ask questions. I will clarify you all those things in the next slides. Any questions here?
So yeah, for this
Rashid, please raise your hand. Rashid, go ahead.
Navin, you told here standby name node is kind of a backup to a name node.
I didn't tell you it is a backup. Secondary name node is a backup. Your name node standby is like, you know, it's a standby like a UPS. If a power goes, UPS acts like a power, right? Power supply.
Okay, so like that's what my question was, like, if you already, you know that you have a standby node, mm-hmm. then why the secondary name node is required?
Optional.
Like, I know when.
It is optional.
It is optional.
Yes. But however, you will have, I will tell you, for that you have to understand what is secondary name node. I will tell you in the next slides.
Okay.
It is optional to answer your point. But if you have, you get some benefits. You see what is that benefits. However, with it is not required also. Now, if you take in one of the customer deployment, what we have, we are not deploying secondary name nodes anymore. Okay. It is optional. Yeah, Veena, go ahead. Please lower your hand if you have.
So here the standby name node will be in a different system, right? You said that it will be in a different system. So how will be that resource manager will be in, communicate with that standby
name node? All the machines will be communicating with each other.
Okay.
How? I will tell you in the next slide. When I teach about limitations of Hadoop 1.x, I will tell you.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, Naveen, go ahead.
Yeah, same question. Like, what is the purpose of secondary name node?
Okay, I will tell you in the next slide, Anavin. Okay.
Okay.
Right. Ranjan, you are left out.
No questions.
Okay, fine. Yeah, Veena, go ahead.
No, sir. No, I was just done.
Okay.
Waiting.
Try to just lower your hand. Okay, fine. Let me proceed now. Good questions, guys. I'll explain you all those things. Just hold on with the next slide. First thing, try to understand this diagram clearly. Very important diagram. Now, so it is clear that you will have multiple data nodes, right? Now, if you look into the configuration of the data nodes, please observe this. The RAM size is 16 GB. Is it decent enough? Guys, let's keep it interactive. Because let's assume you have 100 nodes. Each machine having 16 GB. So 16 GB into 100 becomes 1600 GB. It's a very decent enough. Okay. Now, if you look into the hard disk here, it has 6 into several terabytes. Is it decent enough?
Yes.
Do you agree to the point that there should be more disk here in the data nodes? Why, Ranjan?
It can be.
Why should I have more disk in the data nodes?
It can be written into separate disks distributed way.
No. The question is, why should we have more disk in the data nodes? The answer for this is because for storing the data. Now, please observe this. If you look into the name node, please observe the configuration is very important. Can you see a RAM having 64 GB? Now, can you tell me where does the processing happens? Processing, do you think processing will happen on the name node or processing will happen on the data nodes?
Data nodes.
Everybody accept to this? Processing happens on the data nodes? Ranjan?
Yes.
Right. Now, if you see, whenever is there any processing will always happen on the RAM, right? Except to the point?
Yes.
Now please observe the configurations here. Here, the RAM is 64 GB. Even though the name node will not responsible of processing, the RAM is 64 GB. Why is a question? I will explain you. Now, if you look into this, the disk is 1 terabyte to store big data. Is it big or small for big data?
Small for big data.
It's very small. Now, can anybody think and tell me why the disk size is less in the name node?
Because the final output will be common.
No. We have not gone to the final output. I'm only talking about storage. I'm not talking about execution here.
Okay.
Why the disk size is less in name node and why it is more in data nodes?
So name node stores the metadata. And data node stores the actual data.
Again, you gave me an answer, but the answer for this is the name node will not store your data. Your data nodes will store the data. That is why the disk size is more in your data nodes. First point.
Yep.
Second point, the RAM is more in your name node and the RAMs will be considerably less in your data nodes. That is because the metadata information, that means, let's assume you have a file. The file will be broken down into blocks of size 128 MB and it will be moved into the data nodes, correct? Which data, how many blocks, which block is in which machine, that information will be stored in name node RAM. That is why RAM should be more. Any questions here? So that the metadata information of your actual data will be stored in your name node RAM. Okay. Yeah, I see some questions. Naveen, go ahead.
So then what is the purpose of a hard disk in name node, active name node?
I'll come 1 terabyte. I'll come back to that. Very good question. Okay, I'll come back to that. Okay. Yeah. Any other questions? I am expecting some question here. What kind of a memory RAM is?
So in real time, really.
No, what kind of a memory RAM is, first question?
Memory RAM is?
No. It's a volatile memory.
Yes.
What do you mean by volatile memory? If system restarts, everything is gone.
Yeah.
Correct? So there is a periodic backup which takes place and then it will push us into the disk actually. That is why there should be some amount of disk here. We'll see that in the next slide. So the period, there will always be periodic backup which keeps taking from by the secondary name node from your active name node. Yeah, Rishit, go ahead.
Is there any reason, I mean, to keep this information in
the
RAM?
Very good. That is what I was expecting the question. Can anybody tell me, is there any reason to keep this metadata information in the RAM rather than in your disk?
If any data node goes down to get back that data.
No. Question is there any reason to keep the data in the RAM, not in your hard disk of your name node? The answer for this is to achieve no demand paging. In operating system, there's a concept called demand paging. Just go through that. Now at the high level, if you store any information in the RAM, the accessing speed when the data stores in RAM is much larger than accessing the data from your disk. So that is the main reason the metadata information will be kept in the RAM, because accessing is very fast when the data will be stored in RAM. Is this clear, Rustit?
Yes.
That is the main answer. Very good. All these things they will ask you in interview questions, especially whoever is trying to apply for 2 to 3 years of experience. They will try to ask you all these interview questions. Okay. Any other questions? Okay. One second.
One second.
Yeah, Naveen, go ahead.
Yes, Ranjan. So if you're storing in RAM, the metadata information, because of any issues, if the server goes down, that then we will lose the metadata.
Definitely we will lose. How to handle this, I will explain in the next slide. Okay. So your basically name node basically maintains two files. One is your FS image and another one is your edit logs. So this information will be stored on your RAM as well as in your disk. Okay. Right. Naveen, go ahead.
Yeah. Instead of having a hard disk, can we increase the RAM itself?
No. Always RAM is a certain disadvantage. RAM is a volatile memory. If system restarts, the data in the RAM will be flushed. To handle that, disk is required, no?
Okay.
Correct?
Okay, yeah.
Okay, right. Yeah, Ranjan, you were asking some question?
No, I'm done.
Oh, fine, very good. Okay, let me proceed now. Please understand this. This slide is the most important slide for the today's module. So if you have any single questions, you raise hands. I will help you out. So let's assume you have a client. A client wants to save 400 MB of data into Hadoop cluster. Now, please don't get confused. The client as a user, please don't get confused. When I meant client here, I've just given the diagram picture as a user. It is not a user. When I meant client, it is a Hadoop library. Please understand this. When I meant client, it is basically Hadoop library. Okay, this is very important. Let's assume you have a client. Client wants to save 400 MB of data into Hadoop cluster. So first thing what client will do is, client will communicate to the master node here. So who is the master node here?
Name node.
So if a client wants to communicate, when a client wants to say 400 MB of data into the Hadoop cluster, the client communicates to the master node. So what master node does is, master node responds back to the client. So in this slide, the arrow marks would be different, but in the next slide, I will explain you more detail. For now, don't go with the arrow marks, whatever is showing you in this slide. So let's assume you have a user. User wants to submit 400 MB of data into the Hadoop cluster. The user here is Hadoop library. Hadoop library communicates to the master node. Master node responds back to the client, telling that where the data has to be kept. So the decision of making where the data has to be kept is taken care by the master node. Depends on various aspects. We will see that later on. So your master node responded back to the client telling that, okay, you have this 400 MB of data. This 400 MB of data has to be broken down into blocks of size 128 MB and 128 MB, and remaining is whatever MB. Okay. So what it does is, please observe this. You have a cluster of machines. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 node cluster. So what it does is, please observe this, the block will be split into a size 128 MB. Now please observe this, I've given with the color code. So the data will be split and it will be stored into these nodes. So all the data, whatever is there, 128, 128, 128 and 60 comprises of 400 MB here. Any questions here before I proceed? Okay, I'll take up the questions again later on. Now what happens, please observe this. Let's assume a scenario if this machine fails. Now what happens to this data? To handle this fault tolerance, Hadoop provides you a replication factor. Of 3, which is configurable. By default, it is 3. So what this will do is, each block will be replicated twice in the cluster. Now please observe this. Each block will be replicated twice in the cluster. 128 MB, 128 MB, 128 MB. Even if this machine goes down, still you can access this block because of replication factor. That is how the Hadoop handles fault tolerance. Any single question here? I'm expecting a lot of questions here. Rashid, go ahead. We'll spend more time on this slide.
Yes, now you said here first copy will be stored in the closed proxy of the client. That's a message here. So
correct. That is not, however, always mandatory. What I meant with this, it will try to check which machine is closer to the name node. So the first block will be kept in that particular machine.
So this closer means, is it by geographical distance?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
But however, you don't tell this in interview, it can't be proved. Because it depends on various factors. It is not just the location. There can be a scenario that the machine which is closer to the master node is almost full. Think about a scenario, the machine which is closer to the master node has lot of failures. So it depends on so many factors. So don't even raise an answer telling that it will place to the closest approximity for the machine. No. Okay, you can remove that point completely.
Okay. And you are telling here replication factor means you are having multiple copies in your cluster.
Correct.
The same data.
For each block.
For each block.
Obviously. Okay. So data means collection of blocks.
Okay. So whenever I need to read a block, so which block
that is the point. That is what Hadoop is a framework. You will only tell you have to read the data. You will never tell to read a block.
Okay. So Hadoop will read that for me, automatically decide the block?
Very good, Rashid. I'll repeat the answer again. Please understand this. Did you, while storing the data, did you tell where the data, where the blocks has to be kept?
No.
While reading also, you will not tell from where the data has to be read. You will only say, I want to read this file. So when you say, I want to read this file, the information will go to the master node. Master node will respond back to the client. Okay, you want to read this data. Read the data from these machines.
Okay.
That is an abstraction. So you have nowhere to tell that you will read a block from this particular machine. It is not.
Okay.
Very, very good question. Yeah. Others, any question? We'll spend sufficient amount of time on these things. It's very important. One second. Yeah, Veena.
Sir, in this example, we are splitting the data into each block as a 128 MB. So in the each system, it will be having 128 MB plus the replication data as well.
Correct. So that means if you're trying to store 1 terabyte of data into the cluster, it internally stores 3 terabytes of data.
Okay, by splitting into the different machines.
Different machines.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, Naveen, go ahead.
So what if other 2 blocks also lost?
Gone. You increase the replication factors. Okay. Right, Naveen?
Okay.
Okay, see, however, the machines are not 2 low-end machines which keeps failing every hour. How many times your laptop hard disk has failed, you tell me? Do you think every year it will fail?
No.
So it's not a low, a cheap, a low-end machines. It's a good, powerful, decent machines. Now, if you take in my company, the configurations of each machine, whatever I showed you in the slides, no, that was a pretty very very old slide, because you know Hadoop itself is pretty outdated. That's the reason we don't update the slide. If you look into this, the configuration of data node, RAM is 16 GB, but the configuration of data nodes, what we have is 128 GB. I'm sorry, 64 GB, what we have, at least what deployment we have is 64 GB. Now just imagine. Do you think it is, and each machine cost, you know, how much approximately what we are trying to purchase and trying to deploy is 1.5 lakh. So that is the price of each machine, just the CPUs. So it is not a low-end machines which keeps failing every time. Clear? Okay. Naveen, did that answer your point?
Yes.
Okay, very good. Yeah, Ranjan, go ahead. Ranjan, I think again you're talking on mute.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
So I was trying to ask, now this is a scenario where we are storing the data in kind of, in single, suppose all the name nodes are in the same data center, right?
But yeah, always do remember, in general, the machines will be deployed on the same data centers.
So is there a chance, like if you have a disaster recovery in another data center, the replication factor will take care of the disaster recovery?
If customers are more worried about these disaster and all, people will definitely go into the cloud-based solutions.
Okay.
And however, there will be a mechanism to take the periodic backup to the cloud. See, oh, even for customers, they will not, let me hold on, Rishit, Ranjan. However, even for the customer, if they lose the data of the transaction information, let's say voice transaction information of 6 months records, it is fine. You agree to the point?
Yes.
Because analysis of 6 months records, analysis of 1 month record, which is important, which gives accurate. Latest. Which will be relevant?
Latest one.
Latest one. So you will also have that intelligent enough to choose which data has to go as a backup. Okay.
I was asking if the master node will have the capability to replicate the data into if the name nodes are available in the multiple data centers.
Please understand, no. You can do it. I'm not denying you can't do it. But general deployment will be on the particular data centers. If at all, if they're more worried, then it will be getting into the actual, you know, the cloud-based solutions. Okay.
So it will be a hybrid cloud in that case.
It can be a hybrid cloud as well. Okay. Because they may have their own cloud solutions. They need not purchase from your Azure or AWS. Okay. They may have their private cloud. So it depends. Okay. Yeah. Any questions before we proceed to the next slide? Okay. Let me proceed. Very good. So assume there's no questions. Okay. Let me proceed. Now, please look at this one. This slide is very important. This slide is very important. Now let's assume you have 200 MB of some weblog data. Now this 200 MB of this weblog data, what happens? It will be split into blocks of size 128 MB and 72 MB. And what is this metadata? The metadata is nothing but, you know, this 200 MB has been broken down into two blocks. That is block one and block two. Block one, replication one is present in which slave? Block one, replication two present in which slave? Block one, replication three present in this which slave? All this metadata information, where it will be stored? In the name node?
Name node, yes.
Now can you tell me, if I want to read this 200 MB of data, I'm asking a question, Ranjan, you can answer this. Let's assume I want to read this 200 MB of data. Okay. Now the client will communicate to the master node. Yes or no?
Yes.
Now, master node, will it respond to the client the replication of each block or only the first replication of each block?
I think it is a replication of each block.
I'll repeat the question again. Your name node will respond to the client the replication, all the replication of each block, or only the first replication of each block?
First replication of each block, because it doesn't need to know where the backup factor is.
No, you just imagine a scenario, your master node had sent to the client only the first replication factor, and while processing the first replication factor in a particular machine, in our case slave machine, is dead. In that case?
Yeah, in that case it is needed the second replication.
So again, you meant to say the client again will communicate to the name node to get the second replication factor?
No, it should give all replication.
Okay, the answer for this is whatever you gave the first answer. So always your name node will respond to the client of each block only the first replication factor. While processing it fails, then it will try to request to the name node for the second replication factor.
Okay.
Another question here. Now, will it be this way? It will always try to request the first replication factor only. Is there any way, will there be a situation where it will not give the first replication factor? Instead of first replication factor, it will give the second replication factor.
Yes, possible.
What could be the scenarios there?
So if there is a failure only, it will provide the second replication.
You didn't understand the question. The question is for everybody. Just understand the question. I'll give an opportunity to ask, to answer the question. Now, okay, first thing, you agreed that, you know, that your, whenever a client wants to read this 200 MB of web block, your name node will respond to the client the first replication of each block. Okay, one thing is very clear, that it will not, your name node will not send to the client all the replication of each block. Okay, that is clear. It will not send. Now, will it send always the first replication only, is my question. Why not? It will not send first replication. It may send replication two. Will there be a scenario?
If it will have a record of like failure of the first replication, then only it should send.
Very good. There can be a scenario, not just about the failure. There can be a scenario that slave one resource is fully utilized by some other job.
Yes.
Okay. There can be a scenario that slave one resource is completely utilized by some other job. So now for some other job, if it sends a replication one, I mean, that particular same machine is fully occupied. So it will wait for the resource, right?
Yes.
So that is the reason it may not send always the first replication factor. Okay. Yeah. Any other questions on this slide? Okay. I see there's no questions. Let me proceed. Rajdeep, do you have any question?
No, we can proceed.
Okay, let me proceed to the next slide. Now, look at this, the concept of rack awareness. This is a very important concept. Can anybody tell me what you meant with rack? Rashid?
Is it the storage, like layer, number of systems put
correct.
Together?
So you would have seen in your company's labs, right? You'll have like a tray where you will have CPUs plugged in.
Correct. Yes.
So that is what we call it as a racks. Okay. Now, please look at this. Let's assume you have some data. The data has been broken down into three blocks. Some data. Okay. Let's assume you have a data. The data has been broken down into three blocks. Now, please understand the concept of rack awareness. Now, what happens? The first replication factor. Let's assume some data is there. The data has been broken down into three blocks. Now, please understand this. The first replication will be in one rack. Please understand this. The first replication will be in one of the rack. And the second and the third replication of the same block will be in the same rack. Can you see this? Similarly, the first replication will be in one of the rack. The second and the third replication factor will be in the same rack. Did you see the behavior here? This is what we call it as rack awareness. Now, question is, why the third replication factor is not in a different rack is the question. So by default, your Hadoop uses the concept of rack awareness. So when you use the concept of rack awareness, the first replication factor will be in one of the rack. the second and third replication factor of the same block will be in the same rack. Question is why? Can anybody think of an answer for this?
Are we talking about the data center racking?
In one data centers, you may have multiple racks.
So that is where I'm talking about. Like, does Hadoop understand the server's rack and based on that it create the rack?
No, no. Right? Question is why the second and third replication has to be in the same rack? Why not in another rack? Why did they choose this approach?
No idea.
Okay. Okay. Anybody? Okay. The answer for this is the node failure chances are slightly more than the rack failure. First point. There cannot be the rare scenario that rack itself getting failure. There can be a node failure. Okay, that is one reason. And another reason is the data transfer between the rack's speed and the data transfer within the rack, which will be faster?
Within the rack.
Within the rack.
Within the rack, it will be faster. That is one reason they have chosen this, the concept of rack awareness, that rather than storing this particular block in a different rack, try to store the data in the same rack. Why? Because the inter-rack failure is a little rare scenario. That is only happens when there is a disaster. Okay. So this is the approach what they have followed by default. Okay. Clear. And however, do remember when we start developing, we need not know where the data is stored, which rack, all those information, absolutely we will not tell. We will only tell, I want to process this data. That's all. So underlying all those things happens. Okay. Any questions here? Okay. Let me proceed to the next slide. Now, what is name node? Anybody can tell me? Veena, can you tell me what is the name node?
It stores the file, but not the metadata, but not the actual data.
Correct. Name node is one of the servers in Hadoop, which actually stores the metadata information. Now, name node, please look at this. Name node does not store the files, but only files metadata. And where does it store? Naveen, can you tell me? Where does the metadata information will be stored, on your disk or in your RAM?
RAM.
Why?
Initially, it will store in RAM. Later, it will move to the...
No. It will be stored in RAM only. Still, I have not come to that concept.
Okay.
Anyway. So, NameNode does not store the file, but only files metadata. NameNode keeps track of all the file system related information, such as block locations, information about the file, permissions, ownership of a file, last access time for a file, user permissions, all those information the NameNode will store. It is not just the block location. All the file system permissions or the last access time, every single information it will try to store in the name node. The entire metadata is stored in the main memory. I told you why it will be stored in the main memory to achieve no demand page. Okay. And name node also sees the health of the data node and coordinates access to the data stored in the data nodes. So these are the functionalities of your name node. Can I proceed? Okay. Any questions? Okay, I see there's no questions. Let me proceed. Now, please understand this. The entire metadata is in main memory. That is to achieve no demand paging of FS. FSCL stands for file system metadata. Now, your name node now basically maintains two files. This is very important. Your name node basically maintains two files. One is your FS image and another one is your edit logs. Now, what is FS image? It is a file. The FS image basically contains the complete snapshot of your Hadoop cluster. This point is very important. Your name node basically maintains two files. Two files. So this FS image basically contains the complete snapshot of your file system. Okay. Now, edit logs contains the incremental changes what you do for the file system, like you may add a file, you can delete a file, you can append some records to a file, you can change the permission of the file. All these incremental changes, what you do, that will be recorded to the edit logs. The process of combining this FS image and edit logs is what we call it as checkpointing. Okay, so what checkpointing will do is it will combine FS image and edit logs, and it will try to create a new FS image, and this new FS image will be transferred to the secondary name node. And this happens every 1 hour once. We will see in the next slide again. This happens every 1 hour. Any questions here? There's one question I'm expecting here. So your name node basically maintains two files. One is your FS image, which contains a complete snapshot of your Hadoop cluster, and edit logs. So edit logs contains the incremental changes what you do for the cluster, like you're adding a file, deleting, changing the permission of the file. So there is a something concept called checkpointing. So what is checkpointing is the process of combining FS image and edit logs and creating a new FS image is what we call it as a checkpointing. Any questions here? Okay. Yeah, Ranjan, go ahead.
How does it create a new FS image if there is a FS image already available?
See, FS image is a snapshot. Now there can be new files keep coming into the system, right? So it will not append to the FS image. It will be appended to the edit logs.
Okay.
So when the checkpointing happens, these edit logs has to be combined to the FS image. And this FS image will be taken as a backup to the secondary name node.
Okay.
So this FS image contains the metadata information.
Okay. So it is stored in the secondary name node.
First it will store on the name node, and then the secondary name node will take it to this secondary name node.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, Naveen.
So this FS image and the edit log both will be available in RAM, or where it exactly?
It will be there in the RAM. And you can also configure, it will be there in the disk also, but it will be there in the RAM basically.
So can you elaborate more about the FS image and the edit log?
See, FS image is just like, the snapshot. It's like an ISO image of your Linux file system. It tells how many nodes you have, which all data is there in which machines. That is what is this FS image. Edit logs, after creating the FS image, you have adding more files into the cluster. So rather than appending to the FS image, it will append to the edit logs. And after certain size, it reaches to the edit logs, checkpointing will happen. It is not just with the time. It is also based on the size of the edit logs. I think by default size, if I remember, it is 128 MB, I guess. So when the size of the edit logs reaches 128 MB, checkpointing will happen. So during checkpointing, what will happen? It will combine FS image and edit logs, and it will create new FS image. And this new FS image will be transferred to the secondary name node. And again, this new FS image will be loaded back to the name node RAM. So it will flush the edit logs. Again, next you add any file, it will be added, that transaction information will be added to the edit logs.
So here FS image will be having only one data information every time, or every time it will FS image also flushes?
No, it will, what do you mean by flushes? I didn't understand.
You are telling that FS image contains
complete snapshot of your cluster.
New file system.
Okay. When I say cluster, it is a file system.
Okay. So every time it will flush the information in the FS image also?
No, flush I meant means, I don't know why you came up with the terminology flush. What I'm saying is the process of combining FS image and edit logs and creating a new FS image is what we call it as checkpointing. And this new FS image will be loaded to the name node, and it will be given to the secondary name node. I didn't understand why the concept of flush came into the picture here.
Oh, no, you are telling some after the edit log size increases,
checkpointing will happen.
Better, yeah. So the data in the edit log will flush. You are saying something, right?
No, no. I'm not sure. Did I tell that? But the process of once the edit logs size increases, it will combine. FS image and edit logs will be combined, and it will be placed into the name node disk. And then the same new FS image, whatever it has created, it will be loaded back to the RAM, and then the new FS image will be given to the secondary name node as a backup.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Yeah, Rajit, go ahead.
Naveen, you just told that FS image is the snapshot of the cluster.
Correct.
And it will also have the metadata information.
Yes.
And then, like, if it is, why this edit log is required, like to create a, one more file to put the incremental changes instead of...
That's what, if you see the point I've written, it is not suitable for making small incremental updates like renaming a file or remaining a single. Thus, rather than writing new FS image every time the namespace is modified, the name node instead records the modified operation into the edit logs for durability. Okay. So that is how the architecture has been designed. So rather than for the small incremental changes, what you do for the cluster, rather than appending to the FS image, they have created edit logs for durability. So the transactions, whatever you do, like adding a file, it will be recorded into the edit logs.
Anyways, they're appending it to again FS image and creating a new FS image.
That is because when the restart happens, it will simply try to load the FS image. If there is edit logs, no, if it tries to read the edit logs, whatever transactions you have done, it will try to replay, which is bad. That is why it will try to combine.
Okay. So that FS image will be, whenever it restart happens, it will be loaded to?
It will be loaded to the RAM.
RAM.
Okay. If there is edit logs, then what all transactions you have done to the edit logs, no, it will do replay again.
Okay. That's okay. Bad, yeah.
Right. Okay. Yeah,
Veena. Sir, that new FS image, is why it is creating on the secondary name node? Why can't it be on the name node itself?
Anybody can answer this?
Because I feel name node is already having a current active
FS. No, if name node is completely killed or dead, something happened to the complete name node, then what happens to the metadata?
And that goes to the bias.
Correct, right? Something happens to the complete name node. When you have metadata only, right, you will know where your data is. If you don't have the metadata information, even if you have the data, you will not know which data is in which machine. Clear?
Yeah.
So that is
so whenever the edit log will be used, that time only the secondary name node will get creates for the new FS image.
No. When the checkpointing happens, what is checkpointing? Okay. The process of combining FS image and edit logs. When it will do checkpointing is a different question. Checkpointing happens every 1 hour, which is configurable. And checkpointing also happens when the size of the edit logs reaches certain size, checkpointing will happen. When checkpointing happens, your FS image and edit logs will be combined into a new FS image. And this new FS image will be transferred to the secondary name node as a backup.
Okay.
Right. Any other questions, guys? Okay. Now let me proceed to the next slide. There you will get some more questions so that I'll help you out. Now, can you see this? When does the checkpointing happens? Can anybody tell me? At what interval?
Every hour.
Now think about a scenario. Now let's assume the time is now, let's assume 2 o'clock. Now checkpointing happened at 2 o'clock, for example. Okay. Now 2 to 2:15, some more data came. Where does that entry will be added? Checkpointing has happened at 2 o'clock. Now some more new data came into the cluster. That entry will happen where? Will it happen edit to the logs. FS image or it will happen to the edit logs?
Edit logs.
Edit logs. When does the next checkpointing happens?
3 o'clock.
Let's assume 2 to 2:15 some more data came. 2:15 to 2:30, 2:45 some more data came. Okay. Let's assume 2:45 your name node failed. Now, can you tell me, is there anywhere whatever data you got it from 2 to 2:45 data is there in the data nodes, but metadata is lost. Why it is lost? Because checkpointing happened at 2 o'clock. The next checkpointing will happen at 3 o'clock. But whatever the transactions which has happened from 2 to 2:45 is gone. Do you accept the point?
Yes.
No, I think that is where the standby node will come
in. Correct. So that is why, that is where the concept of standby node comes into the picture. So secondary name node is not a standby name node. That's why I've given the first point. It is not a hot standby for the name node. So what, that is the limitation of Hadoop 1.x architecture. In Hadoop 1.x, you had only one name node. So you, for disaster recovery, you had only one multiple secondary name nodes. So the incremental, whatever it has happened from 2 to 245, it's gone in Hadoop 1.x. However, in 2.x, you have multiple standby name nodes. It is not required to have secondary name node, not required, but however, you can have it also. Clear? Yeah, Rishit, go ahead.
The standby node will also do the same activity as activity node at the same time?
No, only one name node will be active.
So you said the data is coming at 215, 245. So correct. How does the standby node will have that information at the same time?
That is because this edit logs will be stored in a shared directory, like network file system.
So that means even the main active name node is down, the edit log is shared with another standby node.
Correct. Which I'll discuss again when I teach you 2.x. So at a time, if there is two name nodes, one name node will acquire a lock for this FS image and edit logs. So if one name node dies, the lock will be released. So other name node will know that a lock is released. That means that name node is down, so that it will try to read.
Okay.
However, questions on these kind of things would be slightly less. The reason is the course is more inclined to the development. So you'll have a lot of development questions rather than on these kind of architectural questions. And moreover, Hadoop is a little outdated. Okay, people are not using it that much when compared to the Spark, all those things. But anyhow, so it's good to learn. Anyhow, let me proceed. Now, please look at this. We will look into the Hadoop components. So first thing, we have a master and slave nodes. So in the master node, we have two services. One is your name node and another one is your resource manager. Correct? Okay. And in the slaves, you have your data nodes and you have your node manager. Correct? Now, please observe this. There is always a periodic, there is always a communication between the slave nodes and the master node. The first communication is what we call it is a block report. First communication is your heartbeat. So your name node periodically receives a heartbeat from your data nodes. By default, it will send a heartbeat every 3 seconds once. So your slave nodes will communicate to the master node every 3 seconds once. The first communication is what we call it as heartbeat. So what does heartbeat says is it tells to the master node telling that the slave nodes are alive. Now, can you tell me why is that required? Why should the master node knows that slave is alive?
Because that is where the processing will happen, all the requests will be.
Correct. If the master node doesn't know if the slave is alive or not, for the next job when it executes, it may allocate that particular machine, right? Which is dead. So because master node didn't know that it was alive. Correct? So that is why there is a periodic communication happening from your slave nodes to the master node. One is your heartbeat, which happens every 3 seconds once. This is one more important interview question. What if a particular data node doesn't send a heartbeat for the name node in 3 seconds? Will it assume it is dead or it will not assume it is dead? Okay, the answer for this is it will not assume it is dead. It will assume that it is temporarily down. There is one more configuration which says that if I don't get beyond the certain time, then it will assume it is dead. It is not that heartbeat, if it doesn't get it in 3 seconds, it will not assume that it is dead. It will assume that it is temporarily down. There's another configuration which says that if it goes beyond that particular time, then it will assume it is dead. So that is first communication happening from your slave nodes to the master node. And there is another communication happening from your slave nodes to the master node is what we call it as block reports. Now, what is block reports means? Data node keeps sending the block reports to the master node, telling that I have these many blocks stored in the in my particular data node. Now, question is why it should send? In your master node knows the complete information, right? Why should the data node should send that? Data nodes have these blocks in the machine. Question is that. Anybody? Rashid?
So master node will get that, update the metadata information if there is any change.
Correct. To keep the data, master node knows where the data has to be kept. Again, why it is required for the data nodes to send to the master node what blocks it stores.
So if there is any change,
change has to happen through master only, right?
Yeah.
This is an important interview question, actually. Okay. Now, think about a scenario that, data node stores certain blocks. Obviously, name node, it's the one who gives, decides telling that what data has to be stored in which block. But think about a scenario, a particular block got corrupted. Chances are that your hard disk particular block got corrupted. Or will name node knows which block got corrupted? So your data node keeps sending the updated block information to the name node, telling that all these blocks are healthy. All these blocks are healthy. Clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Any questions on this slide? Okay. Let me move on to the next slide. Now, look at this. Anatomy of file write. Okay. Now, in the previous slide, when I explained you, I told you Hadoop is a library. When I say a file, whenever you want to copy a file, let's say 200 MB of file, when I mentioned user is nothing but a library. Yes or no? Guys, you're there with me?
Yes.
Okay. Now, please understand this. Let's assume you have a file by name 2016-apache-logs.txt. Now let's assume you want to move this file to the root directory of HDFS. So you execute this command, HDFS, DFS, -put command. You're trying to say this is basically an Hadoop command. This is what we are going to see in the second or third module. Completely we will try to do hands-on. So when you execute this command, what happens is you're trying to move this file to the root directory of HDFS. Okay, so when you move the file to the root directory of HDFS, please understand what happens. You see, this diagram will explain you all those things. So let's assume you have three racks. Each rack comprises of three nodes. Now, you have a file by name 2016-apache-logs.txt, which is of size 200 MB. And let's assume block size, I've taken it as 64 MB. You can change it to 128 MB. Okay, so replication factor configured is, let's say 300 MB. Is that fine, guys? Hello? Okay, so yes. You can assume this as 300 MB. You can assume this as 300 MB. Okay, so now what happens when you execute a command? What is the command? HDFS, DFS, -put command. You execute a put command. So that's what I'm saying. So library, when this user will execute this command, he will say which file has to be moved to which particular location. So I'm saying move it to the root directory of HDFS. So when you execute that, what happens? Your library will communicate to the name node. Then name node will respond back to the client. Okay, you have this file, which is of size 300 MB and replication factor is 3 and the block sizes, I'm sorry, it is not 64 MB, it is 128 MB. So your name node respond back to the client telling that, okay, your file can be broken down into three blocks. The first block, keep it in data node 1. Second block, keep it in data node 5. Third block, keep it in data node 6. The first replication of block 1, second replication of block 1, third replication of block 1, it'll send you all the locations of each block replications also. Okay, then what your library will do, please understand this. Your library is responsible of splitting the file into blocks. This is a very important interview question. Your name node will never split a file. your name node will only respond to the client telling that where the data has to be kept. It is not the responsibility of name node to split the file. It is the responsibility of the Hadoop client to split the file into blocks of size, whatever is configurable. So now what your library will do is your library will split of size into 128 MB, 128 MB, and remaining is your 44 MB. Now what happens, please understand this. Now what happens, the block zero, first replication factor, and block one's first replication factor, and block two's first replication factor will be kept on the data nodes parallelly. Please understand the arrow marks here. It will kept parallelly. Okay? By the client. Can you see this? Block zero. Block zero is this. Block zero is kept in the data node one. Similarly, block one is kept on the data node four. This is block one. Block one is kept on the data node four. And block two, it will be kept on the data node seven. This happens parallelly. This is very important. And then, please understand this. And then the second replication factor of block zero from data node one to data node five will be transferred not from the client. It will be transferred from the data node one to data node five, data node four to data node eight, data node seven to data node three parallelly. So the first replication, second replication factor happens in sequentially, but copying blocks happens in parallel. Can you see this? This happens. Similarly, the block zero from data node five will be kept into data node six. Similarly, data node eight will keep the block in data node nine. Similarly, data node three will keep the data node, where is data node three? Sorry, block two has been kept in data node seven, and it is also kept in data node three, right? Okay, this is not, I think slightly numbering is wrong. Anyhow, the first, I think it's clear, right? So then it will copy to the next one. Okay, so this happens in parallelly. And there is always a reverse acknowledgement which takes place. There is a reverse acknowledgement which takes place. Okay, there is always a reverse acknowledgement which takes place. That's all. This is not data node 3, this is data node 2. Any questions here, guys? This is what is anatomy of file, right? Any questions before we proceed to the next slide? Ranjan?
No questions.
Okay, right. So others assume that there's no questions. Anyway, let me proceed. So same thing happens during your file read. So your name node will respond to the client the first replications of each block. However, I told you it may not be the first replication, but it will send you the only one replication factor of each blocks, and it tries to read. It tries to read. Okay. If there is any error on this particular data node 4, then it tries to read the second replication factor. Okay. Any questions in these two slides, guys? So I assume there's no questions. Let me proceed. Okay, now look into this particular slide, a very important slide. So here I'm talking about the components of Hadoop ecosystem. The components of Hadoop ecosystem. Okay, I see the components of Hadoop ecosystem. So if you look into the components of Hadoop ecosystems in Hadoop 1.x, obviously we have HDFS. What is the responsibility of HDFS, Naveen?
What is the purpose the data.
Of, no, the purpose the of data. HDFS is now storage. For storage. Okay. Yes. Now, please observe this. On top of this HDFS, you have a MapReduce. Now, please understand this is very important. Many people doesn't know this. Now, on top of HDFS, you have MapReduce. That means any data which is stored in HDFS, the only interface to access the data is MapReduce. This is very important. I'm talking about Hadoop 1.x. Okay. So any data which is stored in HDFS, the only interface to access the data in Hadoop 1.x is only through MapReduce. However, nowadays MapReduce has lot of limitations. People are not using MapReduce anymore, but however, that is a different story here. So the only interface to access the data is MapReduce. That means if you want to access the data in HDFS, you have to code using MapReduce. Okay, just think about that. Now, there is a lot of high level wrappers which is built on top of your MapReduce. One, what we call it as Hive, and second one, what we call it as Pick, and for third, what we call it as Mahout for performing your machine learning. Your Hive is like your SQL. Hive is like your SQL. So your in Hive, we call this SQL as HQL, which stands for Hive Query Language. So when you write your HQL query, the query will be translated into MapReduce program, and then it will be executed and it will be read the data. Similarly, there's another component by name Pig. All these things are, don't even learn all those things. Pig at all is not at all used in the industry anymore. Don't spend unnecessary time learning things which has become very, very obsolete. Okay, so Pig is another component which is actually a high level thing which sits on top of your MapReduce, which in Pig we write something called as Pig Latin. So when you write it in Pig Latin, the Pig Latin will be converted into the MapReduce and the data will be read. Okay, now if you look into the entire Hadoop ecosystem, there's another component by name Scoop. Now what is the Scoop is? Scoop is basically a tool which is used to import the data from your RDBMS to HDFS, from HDFS to RDBMS. Okay, that is what is a component of Flume. Sorry, component of Scoop. Now, if you look into this, there's another component called Flume. Flume is used to take the data, let's say unstructured data or the semi-structured data from the components like Twitter, Facebook, and move the data to the HDFS. So all these are absolute anyhow. So Flume is used for those kind of a scenarios. And if you look into this, in the entire Hadoop ecosystem, there is one database by name HBase. HBase sits on top of your Hadoop ecosystems. Okay, so HBase is a category of NoSQL database. I will explain you what is NoSQL database once I get into the topic. Anyway, we don't cover HBase, all those things. We cover MongoDB. See, anything which sits on top of Hadoop ecosystems, as much as possible, try to come out of it. Okay, that is better. Any questions in the complete ecosystem in 1.x? I'm expecting some questions here. Veena? Any questions? Rashid, go ahead.
Yeah, here, Naveen, there is no, how does this management things, does this MapReduce will be responsible for managing the jobs?
Yes.
And HBase is part of the MapReduce
framework? HBase, it is not on top of. HBase sits on top of HDFS.
Okay. No, it is shown as part of the MapReduce layer.
It sits on top of HDFS, and HBase internally converts. HBase directly communicates like this.
Okay, so MapReduce communicates to HBase. HBase communicates to HDFS.
No, HBase is a thing which is written on top of your HDFS.
So that's a storage system only.
It's a storage system, but underlines HBase stores the data in HDFS only. Uh-huh. Yeah. For HBase, there is a new syntax for querying HBase. Okay. High Pig Latin all are wrappers on top of your MapReduce.
Yeah.
Okay. HBase internally uses MapReduce for allocating the resource and all. That is why it is shows like it is embedded.
Oh, okay.
Okay. More about this, I will tell you again. Okay. Now, the main limitations of this Hadoop 1.x, can you see this? The main limitation is any data which is stored in HDFS, the only way to access the data is through MapReduce. That point you have to remember. I'll reiterate, in Hadoop 1.x, any data which is stored in HDFS, the only way to access the data is through MapReduce. MapReduce has a lot of disadvantages. So, however, if you are using Hadoop 1.x, you can't use anything apart from MapReduce. That is why in Hadoop 2.x, please observe this, they decoupled at the high level. Now you can understand that MapReduce was doing two things. One is processing. Again, I will explain you all those things when the particular topic comes. It was doing processing and it was doing resource management. In Hadoop 2.x, they decoupled processing and then decoupled resource management. Resource management was taken care by YAR. And processing is taken care by one component by name MapReduce. Since they decoupled resource management and processing, you can plug in your third party processing frameworks like Spark. Very, very important. So that means if you want to use Spark, you have to use Hadoop 2.x architecture. Okay, now in this entire Hadoop architecture, some of the frameworks are in future becoming absolute. For example, this is absolute. This is becoming 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 absolute. And this NEO, it has become absolute. Can you see most of the components are becoming absolute on the Hadoop framework? What is widely used is YAR. What is widely used is HDFS in the industry. Any questions? I'm expecting some questions here.
So Naveen, instead of if you are telling if this these things are getting absolute, so is there any replacement is coming
in? Yes, that is why the entire focus will be. That's why if you remember, that's why you, if you would have attended my, I think program orientation session, I told you this program is designed for working professionals. That means in the Spark world, we will tell you what are those alternatives we have.
Okay.
That is why I'm trying to tell you we will spend enough time on Spark. Clear?
Yeah.
Okay. See, all these things are very easy. All these things are very easy. Even I teach you Scoop, I teach you Hive, all those things, it's very easy. But spend more focus on your Spark. However, there are people still who teaches you Flume, who teaches you Pig, all are absolute technologies. Don't even spend time.
But nothing, Scoop is still used.
We have alternative.
Okay.
We have alternative, which is much efficient than Scoop.
Okay.
Okay. Clear?
So
there can be some legacy projects which is already built, right? So all of a sudden, you can't change the legacy projects immediately, right?
Yes.
Even people are using Pig. To be honest, there was one requirement in CTS. People are using Pig. They are not getting resources. Pig is outdated. You will only get candidates who know Pig, who have undergone training. You will not get from working professionals. Clear? Okay. Any questions here? Okay, on top of this, you know, this Apache Uzi and all, they use nowadays, people are using something called as Airflow. Things like that. And HBase, people simply teach you all this HBase. Don't learn HBase because it sits on top of your HDFS. Okay, so people are using on top of this HBase, people are using very widely like MongoDB, Cassandra, these two are very widely used. So that's why as part of your curriculum, we'll be teaching you this MongoDB. Guys, you're there, am I audible?
Yes, yes, you are.
Okay, suddenly I thought I'm lost. Okay, is this clear guys, can I proceed? Any questions? Okay, next 5 minutes, we will not go into any of the slides. We will just take up the questions. Okay, we'll go from person wise. The first question, I think, Karanjan, any question you can ask so that, you know, we'll get into the discussion. Yeah, Ranjan, go ahead.
No, I was asking a question earlier. I think I got clarified during the discussion.
It got clarified. Any other questions you have? No?
No, for now.
Okay. Oh, very good. Yeah. Naveen?
Yeah, is it like we required for processing, we required Hadoop, right? For like Spark.
No, I didn't understand your question still.
No, if you're learning Spark, it is for processing, right? And right. For storage, we can use for Hadoop.
Why?
HDFS.
Why? I can use Amazon S3.
Okay, there is alternate way, but
yes.
You are going with Hadoop, then
yes.
we can use HDFS.
Yes. To answer the point, yes.
Okay.
Okay, the answer I gave you is it is not just HDFS. That's what I wanted to tell you.
Yeah, I got it.
Okay. Any other questions, Naveen?
Nothing.
Okay. Yeah, Veena?
Here in this alternative way of the for this scope, we have MongoDB and Cassandra, right?
So I didn't tell you alternative to scope is MongoDB and Cassandra. I told alternative to HBase is MongoDB and Cassandra.
Sorry, yeah, alternative for the HBase is the MongoDB and Cassandra, right?
No, so
is it
sleeping,
totally
no?
free from the Hadoop? No.
Okay.
Sorry if I missed anything.
Okay, tell me.
So is it totally independent from the Hadoop? Because the HBase, you told it, again, it's storing on the Hadoop layer only. So that's the reason.
No, I didn't understand your question still, sorry.
See, MongoDB and the Cassandra, both are totally independent from the Hadoop, right?
Yes, it's not totally. No. You can install MongoDB in a separate machines. It is not tied to HDFS.
Okay.
So that is how the trend is going on now. Almost all 100 plus of the companies, I can say 90 plus of the companies are into this only from past 2-3 years.
Okay.
Yeah. Rashjit, any questions? I think I finished you.
Naveen. So in Hadoop 2.0, MapReduce still exists?
It still exists.
So if we use any other framework like Spark and all, then MapReduce have no use.
No.
Like
MapReduce, no, absolutely no use. You know, actually, there's one article, I'm not sure where I read. In the near future, they're trying to remove MapReduce only. Oh. It's not used. It's not at all used. It's only training institutes teaches you MapReduce. But however, I also cover. There is enough things, important things for you to do. If you ask me, in my company, people are working, if who are very, very experts in big data, if I ask them to write MapReduce, they will not know how to write MapReduce. It is as simple as like this. Do you know how to write assembly level language?
No.
Can you be a good C programmer without knowing assembly level language?
No.
It is not possible to learn C without assembly?
It is possible to learn, but yeah, it is you. If you know assembly language little bit, then you can.
Nowhere. I don't think so. I am a little against that.
You will be able to know this code like data type and this.
Absolutely no. Nobody will know assembly level language now. The best of best developers you take in your company, even if you ask the instructions how your microprocessor works, they will not be able to tell.
They will not. Yeah, that's true.
So they are very good programs because they are using high-level languages now.
High-level
So it is absolutely not required to know MapReduce, but yeah, at least some little bit knowledge if you have, it's very good. So there you will understand how the shuffle happens, things like that. But anyway, we will explain you, but I'm trying to tell you, give a clear roadmap, what focus you have to give. That is what I wanted to tell you.
Okay, so actually in Hadoop 1.0, you just store like storage and processing. For processing, when it comes processing, there is the only thing is MapReduce.
Or resource allocation also MapReduce.
MapReduce. So in Hadoop 2.0, if somebody asks a question like for a processing, so there are there is no specific answer. Like
no,
there can be a Spark and there can be any other things also.
Yes. So but why do you use the Spark?
Any other thing is there, like they may not be used, but anything else is there apart
if you see other, I have mentioned other YARN frameworks like MPI, Graph, you can search in Google for that.
Okay, they are YARN frameworks, but anything on processing?
That is all processing only.
Oh, that's all processing.
Yes, it sits on top of your YARN.
Okay.
Clear?
Yeah, clear. Thanks.
There is something called as GraphX. There's a lot of things. Okay. So did you get the roadmap of, Ranjan, go ahead.
Are you going to cover Airflow also?
Did you attend my orientation session?
Yeah, I attended, but I forgot actually.
So no, we don't cover.
Okay.
Right. Okay. Let me proceed to the next slide. So I think there's no questions. Let me proceed then. Okay, now it's a time to think. Can you tell me what could be the limitation of Hadoop 1.x? Yeah, Navin, go ahead.
Yeah, single point of failure that name node goes down.
Correct.
Cluster will, yeah.
Correct. In Hadoop 1.x, can it have multiple HDFS namespace? Okay, you'll understand this answer for this in the next slide. Again, the third question, same. Which of the following are a significant disadvantage in Hadoop 1.x? Which is the correct answer? Ranjan? Ranjan, you're there?
Yeah.
You're thinking or you're on mute?
Single point of failure. Can you hear me?
Okay, the answer is both.
Single point of failure. Yeah.
Answer is both. I will tell you when I teach you. Yeah. Okay. Okay, now let me proceed now. First, let us see what are the challenges of Hadoop 1.x. Okay. The first challenge is no horizontal scalability. This is a very, very, very important point. Now, can you tell me what happens? Let's assume you have a cluster configured with 5 nodes and I want to increase the size of a cluster. Is it possible to scale the cluster? It's an open question. Is it possible to scale the cluster? Is it possible to increase the size of a cluster?
Yes, we can.
It is possible. Now think about a scenario. You are aware of what is horizontal scaling and what is vertical scaling? You are aware of that? Can anybody tell for others what is horizontal scalability and what is vertical scalability? Anybody?
So vertical scaling is like increasing the capacity like RAM memory and other hard disks.
Correct. So very good. Vertical scalability is about adding additional configuration for your existing machine. Correct? Now, what is horizontal scalability?
Adding the more nodes.
Adding more nodes. Correct. Now, the first limitation of first challenge of Hadoop 1.x is no horizontal scalability. What I meant with the horizontal scalability is, so single name node, single namespace limited by the name node RAM. That means you have a name node which is capable of storing 64 GB. Now I want more RAM. So that means I can't scale the name node. The only way to scale name node in Hadoop 1.x is I have to increase the RAM. So that is vertical scalability. Whereas in Hadoop 1.x, same thing. If I have 4 data nodes, if I want to add more, I can add. I can add additional one more data node. I need not upgrade the machines to improve the performance. Whereas name node in Hadoop 1.x, if there is no way that I can scale the name node, the only way is I have to upgrade the name node. That is the first limitation of Hadoop 1.x. No horizontal scalability. Clear? Second limitation, no high availability. Can anybody tell what do you mean by no high availability?
There is no standby.
Standby name node. Okay, so that is what is no high availability. Job tracker overburdened. So job tracker was a component in Hadoop 2.x or 1.x?
1.x.
Hadoop job tracker is part of 1.x. Here, if you see, job tracker spends significant portion of time and effort managing the complete life cycle of the application. I will just give you some points here. When I take you to the yarn, I will explain you more detail. I will repeat the definition again. Please look into this sentence. Spends significant portion of time and efforts managing the life cycle of applications. That means, let's assume one single component, that is job tracker, is responsible of managing the complete life cycle of the application from starting to the resource allocation till the application is alive. The only one component used to take care, that is job tracker. That means if you have hundreds of jobs running, for all those hundreds and thousands of jobs, only one component used to manage the complete life cycle of the application. That is taken care by job tracker. That is why it was overburdened in Hadoop 1.x. Is this clear? Any questions yet? You can raise your hand. Okay. I see there's no questions. Let me proceed. And the next limitation of Hadoop 1.x is you add only map reduce. Okay. So apart from map reduce, you can't process the data which is stored in HDFS. Okay. That is the fourth limitation of Hadoop 1.x. So let's get into each detail. The first limitation, let's say we'll talk about no horizontal scalability. So please observe this. Now let's assume, if you read the slide, you have a single name node running and managing single namespace. Okay. I'm explaining you no horizontal scalability. So let's assume you have one single name node. Okay. One single name node used to manage the complete namespace. Now, let's assume, think about a scenario like this. This is very important. Let's assume you get some data related to voice, some data related to SMS, some data related to your data. Now, if I want to process any data which is stored in voice, who knows where the data is stored? Who knows which data is in which data node? Anybody?
Name node.
Correct? Now, who knows which data is stored for SMS? In which machines? Who knows?
Name node.
Only one name node used to maintain the complete information of all your data. That means, let's assume if there are 100 jobs running for SMS, 100 jobs are running, only one name node used to serve the metadata information for all the clients. So your name node was overburdened. Now with the concept of federation, please understand this. With the concept of federation, what happened is you can have multiple name nodes. That means you can configure in such a way that the data which comes to this voice directory, the metadata information should be stored in this name node one. The data which comes to this SMS directory, this metadata information should be stored in name node two. The metadata information which comes to this data node directory has to be stored in this name node three. So hundreds of jobs comes to executing some jobs related to voice data. Who will serve? This name node will serve. Similarly, next 100 jobs, it will be served by this name node. Similarly, the next 100 jobs, it will be served by this name node. Like this, we will be able to scale your name node. This concept is what we call it as federation. Any questions here? All these things is taken care, I'm sorry. All these things will be taken care by administrators. We as a developer, we will not do any of all these things. It is as part of the administration. Yeah, somebody was asking some question. Yeah, Naveen, go ahead.
Yeah, this federation is happening in 1.x or 2.x?
This is a limitation of 1.x. In 2.x, we have a concept of federation. So horizontal scalability is with 2.x.
Okay.
Now all those things with the limitation, we're trying to solve in 2.x.
Okay, yeah.
Okay. Okay, let me proceed to the next slide. Now, please look at this. So as I told you that you will have multiple name nodes, right? You'll have multiple name nodes. So you can have your voice data sitting in multiple machines also. So this particular name node is configured to access voice data. This name node can access multiple machines because data can sit on multiple machines, right? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, right. So that is what I wanted to tell you in this slide. Okay, let me proceed to the next slide. We'll just skip this for now. Just look at the second limitation. What is the second limitation? No high availability. Can you tell me what you mean by no high availability?
Yeah, if a name node goes down.
Correct. Very good. So here I've clearly told, let's assume 10 a.m. there is a backup to the secondary name node. What do we call this backup? What is the process we call? checkpointing, correct? Now let's assume 10:45, your name node breaks down. Now you can get the data till only 10 a.m. because checkpointing has happened at 10 a.m. This is the main problem with Hadoop 1.x. In Hadoop 2.x, because of the concept of high availability, you have active and multiple standby name nodes, which manages the same data at a given point of time. So in case if the active name node fails, your standby name node will act like an active and serves for the client request. This is a very important point. Clear? Any questions here? Okay. I see there's no questions. Let me proceed. Now, this is a very important slide. Now, I told you this. Can you see this here? Now, all the incremental changes what you do will be recorded in the edit logs. Now you have multiple name nodes. One is active and another one is standby. So both is active and standby name node will try to read the edit logs. But when this name node is active, it will try to acquire a lock on this shared edit logs. The shared edit logs can sit anywhere in, let's say, in the form of network file system. So all the incremental changes, what you do, it will be recorded in the edit logs. So only one name node can be active at a time. So this name node, when it tries to read this edit logs, it tries to acquire a lock when this standby name node reads. So since this name node has acquired a lock, for example, let's assume after some time this machine failed. When the machine fails, it tries to release the lock. So this standby name node keeps looking whether lock got released. As soon as it sees if the lock gets released, that then the standby name node will act like a active name node. Any questions here? All these things happens under the hood. All these things, administrators will take care of all those things. Any questions here?
What is the frequency of checking that?
It continuously keeps polling.
Okay.
So as soon as there is no lock, the standby name node will act like a active name node. Clear? Okay. Any questions so far? Okay. I see there's no questions. Any questions, guys? Okay. Anyway, there's no questions. Let me proceed. Now, can you spend 2 minutes of time to read this? Can you just spend 2 minutes of time to read this? Just spend 2 minutes of time to read this, I'll explain it. Done? Ranjan, done?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Now please look at this here. I already told you this. In Hadoop 1.x, there was one single job tracker which is used to monitor the complete lifecycle of the applications. Let's assume you have client 1, client 2, client 3, like that you have n number of clients. When they submit a job, all the requests will go to the job tracker. And job tracker will maintain the complete life cycle. Here, maintaining the complete life cycle means from the start to the resource allocation, to the resource negotiation, and deleting the resource, and all those things. The job tracker used to take care. So if there is huge number of jobs, only one job tracker used to do all those things, which was getting overburdened. That is the main limitation of Hadoop MapReduce 1. Execution. So in Hadoop 2.x, which I'll discuss in the next module, this is the limitation. With the invent of Yarn, what happens? We try to decouple we try to decouple monitoring the application and resource allocation to a different component. We will see what is that. Okay. So this is the main limitation of Hadoop MapReduce 1.x execution framework. Any questions here? So you have to understand, in Hadoop 1.x, you had only one component called job tracker, which was responsible of monitoring the complete life cycle of the application. Hello?
When your voice is breaking.
Yeah, is it audible now? Due to which, you know, there can always be, you know, a delay with the job executions, all those things. Okay. Yeah. Any questions here? Okay. Right. If you have no questions, I will proceed. Okay. Now, hello. I'm sorry, there was some network issue. Am I audible?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Okay, great. Okay. So, can anybody tell me what are the key takeaways for this particular module? Okay, I'll ask questions. Can you tell me what are the 5 daemon services available in 1.x? Question goes to Ranjan. Ranjan, you're there?
Yeah, it is job tracker, name node, data node, second data node, job tracker, and task tracker.
Okay, out of these 5 services, which services are related to master?
Name node is related to master. Secondary data node is related to master.
Do you accept the point, everybody? Name node, data node, and secondary node is related to master.
Yes.
No.
Data node is
node.
Secondary name node.
This job tracker and secondary name node is related to master. Correct?
Yes.
Okay. Can you tell me, in terms of service, what is replaced when it compared to job tracker in 2.x?
That is resource manager.
Correct. Your task tracker got replaced with?
Node manager.
Node manager. Okay. Anyway, I think Veena is eager to answer. Now question goes to Veena. Okay. Veena, can you tell me what is the block size in Hadoop 2.x?
128 MB.
Is it configurable?
And it can be configurable. Yeah, it can be configurable.
Okay. Now, can you tell me where does the block information stores?
Name node.
Where in name node?
In RAM.
Why?
Because it is speedy accessible.
It is because of faster access.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Now, question goes to Naveen. Can you tell me what is the concept of rack awareness? Naveen, you there? Okay, I don't see.
Yeah, rack awareness is a collection of different name nodes, different nodes where it resides. So.
No. Rashid, what is rack awareness?
First copy always gets stored in one rack, and
correct.
The second and third copy gets stored in another rack.
Same rack. Correct.
Another same rack.
Correct. Okay. Now, can you tell me what are the wrappers which is built on top of your MapReduce? Rashid?
Wrappers means this applications like big.
Oh, you're able to see my screen, right? No, is it? Okay. Right. Yeah. Like this wrappers built on top of your MapReduce is Hive.
Big,
all those things. Okay, so in Hadoop ecosystem, which component is meant for structured data analysis?
Scoop.
Hive. Okay, it is not Scoop, it is Hive. Scoop is a tool which is used to migrate the data from RDBMS to HDFS, HDFS to RDBMS. Clear? Okay. Now, can you tell me some of the design goals of your HDFS?
It is one, you store in one node, you can access it from any other node.
Okay. Okay.
And it is based on the Linux file system.
Okay. One important point. It is designed for storing?
Distributed.
No. It is designed for storing small files or large
files? Large files.
Why? Can you justify your answer?
Because
why it is designed for storing large files?
Because we have a feature to split the file and store in a distributed way. So we can handle the large.
No, it is designed for storing large files. Let's assume, think about a scenario. You have 100 MB data. Let's assume you have 200 MB of data. Let's assume which is efficient. What happens, you have to tell me. Let's say a scenario, this 200 MB of data, you get it in 1 MB, 1 MB, 1 MB, like 200 files will you get. What happens? What is wrong?
I have network bandwidth, I have to use more.
Okay.
And that I have to wait till the last file.
No, that is also fine. One important thing.
And processing guys, also.
No. Guys, I want everybody to think on this. Very important questions. Now, let's assume you have a file. This is a very important identification. Let's assume you have a big 200 MB of file. Okay. You have a name node. You have a data nodes. Let's assume there are 3 to 4 data nodes. Okay. So it will be broken down. Let's assume this 200 MB, if it is broken down into 1111 MB, like the 200 files. If you copy individual file to the HDFS, what is wrong? Why do you say that it is not designed for storing small files? I need an answer. Why it is not efficient in storing small files?
It will take more time to collect the data, process the data.
Okay, that is okay. I'm not getting the answer is right. I'm not getting the strong answer for this.
Naveen, in this system is designed to do storage and processing at
one
side.
So. Why? No, this also is one file. It's one file. It has been broken down into, now I'll process the complete directory, as simple as that. Whatever is there in our directory, I will try to process. Okay. Now, please understand the answer. For every file, don't you think the metadata information will be saved in a file, in a name node?
Yes.
So, if you have 200 files, 200 files, the metadata information it has to store in the name node.
Yes.
So, if the file size is larger, 200 MB, it has to be broken down into 128 MB and 72 MB. So, only 2 files metadata information can be stored in name node, right? Correct?
Yeah.
So that is the main reason Hadoop is not designed for storing small files. It is inefficient to handle small files. Why? Because name node will be overburdened. I'm clear?
Yes.
Okay. Right. That's all for today, guys. I'll just want to tell you one important thing. Did you accept the Google Classrooms, guys? So whoever is not accepted, I see that, one second. Oh, I've sent the invitation, I've accepted. So here you have a concept of stream, okay? So what we will do is every Thursday, we will have a online call for just for 30 minutes or 15 to 30 minutes to clarify your doubts. So what I would expect is you can use this particular platform to ask questions. So you can simply click on this and whatever questions you have, you can ask. Okay, so we will collect on the call on Thursday and then we will clarify your doubts. Is that fine, guys?
Yes.
Even it can be a silly question, don't worry, put it. Let us see. Okay, we will try to answer either on Saturday or on Friday. But it has to be put it before the class. Okay, and I'll be pushing some assignments actually. For today's class. I'll be pushing some quiz also here. So all those things will be accounted for your score. Okay. Yeah. Any other questions, guys? And I think I also
videos.
Videos we don't upload. To answer your point, and did you accept this invitation? No, that's what to answer your point. No. Did you see this point? Welcome and program orientation session. How many people have accepted this?
I have accepted.
Who's only Rashid? Others try to accept.
Yeah.
Okay, there is a stream here. There's the entire things I've just pushed some materials here. I'll be pushing it one by one now. Okay. So can you push your questions by today or by tomorrow, end of the day, in the Hadoop? For each thing, you'll be getting a classrooms so that you know you can. I will answer all the questions. Okay, guys.
Naveen, it is not the video, at least the PPT.
Yeah, we'll be doing that. PPT will be doing that. You'll be able to access the PPT.
Yes, sir. Yeah, just to review, like revisit.
Definitely. Definitely. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Guys, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. I think I have another class for data science now. I think we'll wind it up.
Thanks.
Okay, guys. Try to post all your questions. We'll help you out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, welcome. See you guys.